You hear something, Peggy?
Huh? Hear what?
I thought I heard someone yelling, or... I don't know, a howl.
Forrest, is this a joke?
No, I almost swore I heard something.
Oh, and here I was thinking you'd finally started to ease up. You probably just heard some cats outside.
Cats?
You know, four legs, whiskers, tails, not dogs.
I know what a cat is. But I mean, does Gallows Creek have a stray cat problem or something?
Not since the rats moved in. Anyway, you ready to do the pre-flight checks?
Seriously? Do we have to do these checks every time? And do you have to call them that?
Reggie pays us to check the equipment before each show, and he pays us to call it a pre-flight check. But if you're sure you don't want to...
Let's just get started. I know how this goes.
Okay, Big Shot. Any technical failures tonight are on your head. Now, let's get the show started. After your introduction, our first segment is Guess That Scream.
I thought that was a joke.
Nope, and don't blame me for this one. It's Reggie all the way, and he demands we do it tonight. Okay, you're live in 3, 2...
189.16.
Good evening, Gallows Creek. This is your host, Forrest Nash, and you're listening to 189.16, The Scream. Before we start taking your calls tonight on Gallows Creek's only late-night phone-in talk show, I need to let you know about a special competition we have for you this evening. Guess That Scream.
This is actually one of the station manager's better ideas.
Here's how it works. I'm going to play you a scream, then you call and... guess that scream. We need you to guess why they're screaming. Did they stub their toe, saw off a finger, or... discover the corpse of a loved one.
That's good. Now, Forrest, hit them with the tape.
We'll play that scream in just a second. Listen close, and then call in to guess that scream. Peggy, what do you mean, play the tape? I used to have a tape guy do that for me.
You're not in Chicago anymore, Forrest. Here in Gallows Creek, you get to be your own tape guy. Come on, I gave it to you yesterday. Forrest, you do have the tape right. You knew we were doing this tonight.
Peggy, let's be real. Guess That Scream is a terrible idea. No, I don't have the tape.
It may be a stupid idea, but that doesn't mean it can't be fun. We're going to need a scream tonight, Forrest, and you're the one at the mic, so...
Oh my God. Peggy, I may have sunk low, but I have not sunk that low. I won't do it.
Come on, Forrest, just do it! That's enough dead air already. Just think of a scream and let it rip.
Oh, God. Sorry about that. I'm back. I had to step away there for a second. Listen close, and then call in to guess that scream. Well, folks, there you have it. Call in with your guesses, and if you get it right, you could win 2 tickets to the amazing Maze Maze and 1 free fried dough. Fried dough? Just call in at 555-239-KFAM with your guess. Now, here's some music while you get dialing. Time to go on the journey that is Blast Processor with their hit song, 1980X.
Oh, God, Forrest, that was amazing!
Thanks.
I can't wait to hear what people think that was.
How the hell did I get into this mess?
Lighten up, Forrest. That's gonna be the highlight of my week. Oh, Forrest, there's a call coming in.
Welcome to 189.16... The Scream, caller. You're talking to Forrest Nash. What's going on with you tonight?
Forrest, thank God I made it through. My name is Leslie Harper. I'm the 911 operator and police dispatcher for Gallows Creek.
Welcome to the show, Leslie. Are you calling in to guess that scream? As a 911 operator, I bet you may have an educated guess.
What? No! Look, I found a body and I need your help.
911 is calling me to report a body. Interesting setup. All right, I'll bite. What's the punchline then?
Forrest, I recognize her voice. I'm pretty sure that actually is our 911 operator. I think this is real.
Peggy, I'm not gonna be happy if this is a prank. I don't do prank segments on my shows. It's in my contract.
Forrest, I really don't think this is a prank.
Leslie, I'll level with you. I find this hard to believe, but I'll hear you out. What exactly is going on?
Sheriff Matthews is dead.
What? Sheriff Matthews is dead?
I couldn't get any response from the department. That's never happened before, so I came to the station and I found him.
Oh, God. Poor Sheriff Matthews. Do you know what happened to him?
Someone got him. Someone got up very close and I really don't want to say what they did to him.
Did he fight back?
I don't know. I think he tried. He's surrounded by bullet casings. I think he tried to shoot at whoever it was, but...
I don't understand. Where are the other officers? Do they know? Have they secured the scene or whatever cops are supposed to do?
No. I checked everywhere. Deputy Martinez is here, but she's knocked out, tied up, and locked in a holding cell. I called you right after I found her.
God. Wait. Please don't tell me that this hick town only has two cops.
Don't be ridiculous. We have three. But Officer Gunderson is on leave in Cancun.
Leslie, do you have any idea who could have done this?
Not a clue. I didn't see anything on my way over.
Leslie, you need to call over to Henderson or Quiet Ridge. They need to send someone over from their department.
I tried, but I can't call anything but local numbers. Something's wrong. I'll have to go there myself, let them know what's going on, and bring help back with me.
But if you leave while there's a murderer on the loose, who's gonna man the emergency line?
That's why I called. Forrest, I've routed all 911 calls to come in to you.
I'm a radio talk show host, Leslie. I talk to idiot people about their idiot ideas. I'm not a 911 operator. Why me?
You're the only person with experience manning a phone line around here. You're the only person equipped for the job. Besides, there are lots of transferable skills between the two. It's like an interview. You ask questions to get information you can use. Keep people talking, you know? Guide the conversation and know when to jump in.
You do know that I'm so good at interviews, they sent me from Chicago to Gallows Creek, right?
So I've heard. But that doesn't matter. And besides, there are two of you. You can talk to each other, discuss ideas, work together. Hell, let's have some on-the-job training right now. I have an emergency. I need to get an unconscious Deputy Martinez out of that holding cell. It looks like whoever attacked her threw the keys into the cell after they locked the door.
Is there any way you can reach the keys?
No. There aren't any bars to the cell, and the door itself only has a food tray slot. And that's too narrow for me to reach through.
There's gotta be another way in.
There's gotta be another set of keys somewhere in that office. Those can't be the only one.
Of course. Yes, there must be another set.
Where might another set be?
Maybe Sheriff Matthews had a set of keys on him when he... you know.
I couldn't see any at a glance, but I didn't really look up close. One second. Oh, I think I might be sick. Sorry, Sheriff. I'm just gonna turn you over and... oh. Please don't stare at me. Oh, wait. That might be them. I think I got the cell keys.
Looks like Sheriff Matthews might have saved his deputy. Do the keys work?
They do. Give me a minute to untie Deputy Martinez. I'll be right back.
So far, so good, I suppose. How are you feeling, Forrest?
Yeah, that seemed to go okay. Maybe Leslie was right. Maybe we can handle this 911 business.
That's the spirit, Forrest. I think you're right. Though, I have to say, I really hope this is the only call like this we get.
Same.
Come on, Martinez. There we go. I'm just gonna sit you in your office chair. We'll head to my car in a minute. I'm back. Deputy Martinez is still out cold. I'm taking her in the car with me to get help in Henderson. If the killer came back now, Martinez would be a sitting duck.
That's a good idea. We don't want to take any risk right now.
Thank you, Forrest. You and Peggy just work together like you did earlier. You can do this. Now I'll be back as soon as I... What? My car! My car is on fire!
What do you mean it's on fire?
How the hell? Did it just go up in smoke? What happened?
Wait. What? No. No way. This can't... Well, Forrest, we have big trouble.
What's happening? What's that noise? It sounds like... whistling?
Whistling? It can't be.
Oh my god. I can see him, but... he's dead, right? Right? But that mask... how the hell is he...
Who, Leslie? Who?
The Whistling Man.
The Whistling Man? Who's the Whistling Man?
He was a serial killer back in the 50s. Wore that mask. But he's dead. He's... what the hell?
Oh, God. Do you think he attacked Sheriff Matthews and Deputy Martinez?
He's coming this way.
Leslie, stay inside and lock the doors.
Right. Shit, we need a new plan. My car is torched. We need to think.
There should be police cruisers at the sheriff's office, right? Like, you should take one of those.
Yeah, that could work. Let me check if Martinez has any... just reach into your pocket there, deputy, and... yes, got him. Keys for squad car 3. I saw that parked out front when I got here.
Nice one, Forrest. Good thinking.
But wait. How am I supposed to get us to the car? The Whistling Man is right there.
The sheriff must have a gun, right? Can you see it?
There was a gun next to him. Let me grab it. Shit. It's empty.
He must have emptied it trying to defend himself.
There must be a weapon lockup in the station, right? Could you grab something from there?
I saw it earlier, but as you might have guessed, it was locked. But maybe one of these keys I got earlier will help. Let me see. No. No. No! Shit! None of the keys work.
Are there any other weapons lying around that you could use?
I didn't see anything earlier. Let me check Deputy Martinez's belt. All right. It looks like the Whistling Man left her with a baton, pepper spray, and taser. I can only hold one if I'm carrying Deputy Martinez. Which should I take?
I mean, it's gotta be the taser, right?
Got it. I'm just going to grab Deputy Martinez and then... wait. Do you hear that?
No, I can't hear anything.
Exactly, it's gone quiet. No more knocking.
Maybe the freak decided to up and leave.
Maybe. I think that may be wishful thinking. But I can't see him out there anymore, so... okay, Deputy Martinez, if you can hear me, it's time to move. Just lean on me. Yep, there you go.
Are you sure about this, Leslie?
No time like the present, right? So, here we go. Again, you're hooked into dispatch now, so I should be able to radio you when I reach the car. If I reach it. Speak to you soon.
Good luck, Leslie.
That's one brave woman. God, I hope she makes it through this.
You know, I've got to say, this really wasn't what I expected when I came into work today.
Well, they always say you have to be ready for everything in live radio. Oh, I think we've got Leslie back on the line. I'm putting the call through.
Hello? Forrest? Peggy? This is Leslie. Are you there? Over.
We're here, Leslie. So I guess you made it to the car then. Over.
Sorry about the CB chat. Old habit. But yes, we made it to the car. Deputy Martinez is in the passenger seat, still out cold. I don't see the Whistling Man anywhere, and I don't plan to wait for him. So I'm going to get us moving. Jesus! God damn it! Get back! Get away from her!
Leslie, what's happening?
The Whistling... no! Get off her, you son of a bitch! Yeah!
Leslie, drive!
Don't worry, Deputy Martinez. We're out of here.
Leslie, are you two okay? Did you get away, or...
Forrest, that taser? Definitely the right call. Oh my God, I can't believe we escaped.
Well done, Leslie. You saved a life. Just another day for you.
Oh my God, yeah. But let me tell you, I prefer doing it from your side of the phone.
Leslie, how long do you think it's going to take to get help?
Gallows Creek isn't Nowheresville, but it's pretty damn close. It's going to take a while, maybe 2-3 hours each way. Slightly less if I put my foot down.
You keep that pedal to the floor then. We'll see when you're back.
You don't have to tell me twice. Anyway, once I'm in... Oh, I think Deputy Martinez is starting to stir. Forrest, Peggy, I've gotta go. I'll be out of range soon, but I'll radio back as soon as I can once I got the cavalry.
Take care, Leslie. Be safe out there.
Good luck, Leslie! Feel better soon, Deputy Martinez!
Folks, you heard it here. We've got a killer on the streets of Gallows Creek tonight. Please make sure to stay safe. And Leslie, we're counting on you. We're going to get back to the show, meanwhile. If you have anything on your mind or have any information about this Whistling Man character, then give us a call. We'll talk here on 189.16, The Scream. For now... here's another hit record for you all to enjoy. It's David Scopo with Moonlight. This is not what I signed up for, Peggy.
This is actually insane.
Did she really say it's gonna take her 4 hours? This guy's gonna kill half the town in 4 hours.
Forrest, that's not helpful.
I know, I just... Who is this Whistling Man character anyway?
He was a serial killer back in the 50s. Edward Marshall Mooney. Went around in a freaky mask, whistling, and killed about a dozen folks in Gallows Creek. No reason for it. No motive. He just did.
Okay. What happened to him?
Well, police chased him up to Ellis Point one night. We call it Whistling Point now. And it was, well... it was on this night, actually. The police cornered him, and he jumped into the river. His body was never found.
So is he alive? Dead? I mean, what's the story?
Story is he's biding his time, waiting to take revenge on the town.
All right, that's the story. What's the truth?
Other than we have a whistling killer on our hands tonight, I don't know.
All right. Copycat or ghost killer, I guess we'll do our best.
That's the spirit!
At least we got the word out, I guess. What kind of listening figures do we get at this time?
On a Thursday after midnight? Could be around 35?
35? Isn't 3,500? Huh. I didn't realize Gallows Creek was that large.
No, 35 people. At best.
35 at best?
35, yeah. It's a school night.
And what's the population of Gallows Creek?
I don't know exactly. A little over 1,000?
Oh.
How many did you get before? You know.
Before my career exploded and I ended up on a midnight hour talk show in the town of 1,000 people?
Yeah. Before that.
Around 5 for most shows on the low end. Big gas could pump that up to 10, 15. Easy.
5,000 on the low end? We could only dream of that.
5 million.
Million?
Yeah, sometimes that's just the way it goes. At least the Whistling Man hasn't killed me yet. I guess.
Yeah, I guess we're gonna learn a lot about perspective tonight, huh? Oh, we have a call coming in. Take it when you're ready. Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
Hello, caller. You're live on 189.16, The Scream. Is everything, all right? Okay, who is this? Are you, hello? Hello? Okay, what's your name and why are you calling in? You don't have to do this, Mr. Whistling Man. You don't have to kill again.
Oh, but I do. You must make a sacrifice to us.
A sacrifice? To us?
I mean, me. We want cheese dusted pretzels. I mean, I want cheese dusted pretzels. I'll cut your face off!
Goddamn kids. I'm cutting them off.
Yeah, cut him off.
What? We also want a mega gulp!
For anyone just tuning in, we do, in fact, have an actual killer out in the streets tonight. Anyway. This next one's dedicated to all of you staying inside with your doors and windows locked. Listen in to this next track from Late Night Lurkers, if you dare. Peggy, the hell was that? Kids pretending to be a killer who right now is stalking the town?
It's a thing.
A thing?
Ugh, kids around here. They pull pranks pretending to be him.
By pretending to be this Whistling Man character?
They think it's funny. But it's not. It's not funny at all.
And there's no chance that our Whistling Man was just a prank. That Leslie...
No, that... That's real.
Christ.
Let's stay positive. We still have a show to do. We already have another caller on the line.
All right. Let's do this. Hello, caller. You're live on The Scream with me, Forrest Nash.
What? I dialed 911. I need the sheriff right away!
Okay, right. Well, I'm filling in for 911 tonight. What's your name, and what's your trouble?
My name is Sandra Sharp, and I need the cops now.
I'm sorry, but the cops aren't coming. Leslie's on her way to Henderson for help.
What? Oh, God. Listen, you've got to help me then. I drove to the edge of town for a jazz run, and now some psycho dressed like the Whistling Man is after me, knife in hand.
Oh, God. It's actually happening.
Where are you now? Did you escape to somewhere safe?
Oh, I did, baby. I jazz ran all the way to my car and nothing flat. But I dropped my keys somewhere along the way. I never locked the door, at least, so I've got a place to hide, but I can't get moving.
Can you go back and find your keys?
Well, I'm not going back out there. Oh, shoot. He's back. Look, I don't know a thing about cars, but I gotta start this engine without the keys, and you're gonna have to help me.
Wait, I don't.
If it helps, I got a toolkit buried beneath my spare sweatbands. I'll call you back when I find it.
You're listening to 189.16, The Scream, hosted by me, Forrest Nash. Your friendly neighborhood radio host, mechanic, and savior. Sit tight while the record spins, folks. This one goes out to you, Sandra. Hope you enjoy this one as much as I do. Doesn't the station have a show about cars? The Tamora Twins or something?
Timberline Twins Talk Motors. Yeah. You know they're not even brothers.
Really? They look the same, though.
I know, but they're not even related. It's weird. I asked them about it once, and they got really sweaty and defensive. Anyway, go see what you can find. The offices are out the door and down the hall.
This looks useful.
You find anything?
Yeah, I found a magazine about hot wiring cars.
Well, that sounds perfect. Time to turn the music off. caller on line one.
Thanks, Peggy. We're back with 189.16, The Scream. How are you holding up, Sandra?
The creep's looking through the parking lot trying to find me. But I've got my tools, and I'm ready to get this hunk of junk moving. How do we start this baby?
Unscrew the steering column.
All right. Just turn. 1, 2, 1, 2. God, how long are these screws? Okay, cover's off. There's a bunch of wires down here all paired up and... Oh God, my heart is pumping.
Tell me exactly what you see.
Okay, I can do this. There's a red wire, a blue wire, a yellow wire, a green wire, and a brown wire.
What's the serial number on the steering column?
The number is 576-894-320.
Strip and twist together the red and yellow wires.
All right. We take the red and the yellow, and we twist and we turn. Oh, perfect. I also see pink and purple wire. What next?
Strip the purple wire and brush against the twisted wires.
Okay. We strip and we brush and... Energize your body! Fantastic work, baby! Anytime you want to come down to the jazz studio, you get in for free!
I almost can't believe it, but we did it!
Nice work, Forrest. I bet Sandra is positively jazzed that you answered her call.
You bet I am, baby! We did it, Forrest!
We sure did! Here comes another hit track that we're excited to share with you.
And remember, if you're also having car troubles, then tune in to Timberline Twins Talk Motors here on 189.16, Monday to Friday at 5. Take it away, Forrest. I still can't believe this is happening.
Right? Like Gallows Creek didn't already have enough to worry about?
What do you mean?
Gallows Creek is a miserable place to live.
Really? Miserable?
It's nothing personal, Peggy, but it's not Chicago. Or, hell, it's not really anywhere.
Well, I like it here. People are polite and,
Stab happy?
Don't be awful, Forrest. Come on, there must be something you like about this place.
I guess some folks have been okay. You're not terrible after a while.
Not terrible after a while? High praise coming from Forrest Nash.
You know what I mean, Peggy.
I do. It's Forrest Nash for, I think you're swell. Anyway, I hope the killer is done for the night and that Leslie gets back soon.
Me too. Can we at least call off that stupid Guess the Scream contest now?
Yeah, that'd probably be a good idea. Caller on line one.
Evening, caller. This is Forrest Nash, host of 189.16, The Scream, and tonight's 911 stand-in.
Hey, Forrest. My name is Brian. Brian Ponty. Brian Ponty of Ponty's Pizza.
Hello, Brian. What have you got to say about what's happening?
I'm so happy that Deputy Martinez survived. I've seen her a lot over the years down here at Ponty's Pizza. Oh, you did a really great job. And as a thanks for all you did there, I just wanted to tell you that I'm sending you some coupons for free pizza here at Ponty's Pizza.
Wow, Brian, that's really good of you. But you really don't have to, though.
Oh, it's the least I can do. And if you like it, well, you're in luck, because we're always running great deals that'll have you eating for pennies.
Sounds great, bro.
And let me tell you, the pizza we have is to die for. Oh, poor choice of words tonight, I guess.
That was pretty tasteless, I have to say.
I'm sorry, Forrest. Well, I just hope I didn't put you or anyone else off coming on down to Ponty's Pizza. We've got a great special this weekend. Our famous beer and pizza deal.
Wait a minute.
Come on down to Ponty's Pizza this weekend. You've just got to pay for one slice to get yourself...
God damn it, you're just calling in to advertise your shop. Peggy, hang up on him.
Done. Oh, real quick, before I forget, it's probably time we played a paid ad.
Now, a word from our sponsors.
You know how to play an ad, right?
Sure. Done.
Do you seek ancient wisdom? Do you want to double your power? Are you ready to unlock your inner warrior for only $24.99? Then step into Master Robbie's deadly dojo of Kung Rate and receive direct by video warrior instruction from me, Master Robbie. You will learn the four qualities of an ultimate conqueror. The power of the alligator. The discipline of the tarantula. The speed of the tuna. The poise of the scorpion. And the wisdom of the bullfrog. Using classified techniques, I'll unlock your inner chi after only 5 30-minute video sessions. Ultimate power and wisdom can be yours now for the low, low price of only $24.99. Just call 555-7861-USA to take your first step to becoming a champion. Never forget the element of surprise! If you buy today, you'll receive 2 additional VHS tapes, the Tornado Technique and Karate Lovemaking. Call today!
Do people really buy this kind of thing?
Don't pretend like you're not interested.
I mean, I wouldn't buy them, but I might watch them, I guess.
Yeah, I bet karate lovemaking sure is something. Is Forrest Nash at a loss for words?
Hey, let's just get to the show. Wow, what a deal. Only $24.99. And I'm not just saying that because they're paying for the airtime.
But unless they pay us more, then it's time to get the show moving along with our next caller.
Welcome to The Scream with me, Forrest Nash.
Yeah, Leslie. This is Maurice Russell from the Gallows Reporter. I'm at the office. This guy just broke in downstairs and... Wait. Forrest Nash? I want to speak to 911. Put Leslie on.
What? God, another one?
Leslie's driving to Henderson right now. She left me in charge.
Why on earth is Leslie... Oh, never mind. Just put me on with Sheriff Matthews.
Sheriff Matthews is dead.
Dead? What happened? Did you witness the incident? Are you willing to do an interview for the reporter? I can cite you as an anonymous source, if that's a concern.
We're live on the air. Anything we say can and will be broadcast.
Live on... Damn it. All right. There's obviously a lot more going on than I know.
Yeah, there's a lot happening tonight. You said someone broke in.
That's nothing to get worked up about. Some idiot kid just broke in, dressed as the Whistling Man. Teens. They get worse every year. This punk wasn't even a disappointing twinkle in his daddy's eye when Edward Marshall Mooney stalked the town. But I was there. I covered it.
You don't understand. That's not a prankster. That's the Whistling Man.
Of course it's not. It's a stupid kid. Every year this happens. They think it's funny. Not a big deal, old man. But they didn't live through the terror 30 years ago. Anyway, I know for a fact. Edward Marshall Mooney is dead. I don't know who I'm looking at on the security monitor. But if he killed Sheriff Matthews...
Where are you now?
I'm in the boardroom, upstairs. We got security cameras all around the building. You can watch them on any TV set here. And there's a set in the boardroom.
Maurice, is there any way you can get out of there?
I sure as shit hope so, kid. But I'm not sure how I'm going to do it. That crash you heard was him tipping over my filing cabinets. He's blocking the stairs.
I'm guessing the stairs are the only way out?
That's right. And it would take me a good few minutes to move those cabinets.
We need to do something. But what? All we can do from here is... Forrest, I think I've got it. Why don't we call the killer? They'd have a bunch of phones set up across the office, right? In different rooms, with different extensions? So we call one of them. Draw the killer away.
Buy Maurice time. That could work.
Exactly!
It's worth a shot.
I can hear you, you know. The son of a bitch hasn't killed me yet.
Sorry, Maurice. Peggy and I were just trying to figure out...
You realize how stupid that plan sounds, right? For that to be successful, you're gonna need every phone extension. Plus, a plan of the entire office floor. All delivered while the killer is en route. I've got it. Thank God I've always been cool under pressure. Don't go anywhere.
You don't think the killer got him, do you?
Mr. Russell.
I'm here. The freak's going to be here any second, too. Go check your fax machine. Don't let me down.
I'll go pick up that map then.
Go, Forrest! The fax machine's in the office on the other side of the hall.
Thanks, Peggy. Be right back. Okay, go to the office on the other end of the hall. Grab the fax from the machine. Easy. This must be it.
Hey, did you get the fax?
Yes, I have. Mr. Russell, you still with us?
I am. You get my fax?
Yeah, I got it right here.
Good. I knew you could at least manage that.
Okay, folks, we're back on the line with Maurice. Let's see if we can help him avoid the Whistling Man.
Here's the situation. The Whistling Man searched every room in the hall leading up to the boardroom. And now he's in the office next door. It's now or never. This plan of yours better work.
I'm ready on my end, Forrest. Again, we want to draw the killer away by dialing an extension number, and then move Maurice somewhere safe. So, what extension should I call?
Call the kitchen. The extension is 02.
Got it. I'll put the call through when you're ready.
All right, Nash. Where do I need to go?
You're moving to the archives.
The archives? That's just across from the kitchen. It's going to be tight. Are you sure, Nash?
I'm sure.
I'm ready to place the call. Are you ready, Mr. Russell?
Don't have much choice, do I? Make the call.
Yes, sir. Calling now.
I can't believe it. He's actually heading to the kitchen.
It was all Peggy's idea. Credit goes to her.
Don't mention it.
The coast is clear. I'm shutting off the TV so he won't see me on the security cameras. Then, making my move, I'll call when I get there.
Do you think he'll make it okay?
I'm sure he'll be fine. But now, what do? We gotta find some way for him to get past that barricade.
What do you mean?
I don't think calling the Whistling Man is gonna buy Maurice enough time to move those cabinets. We gotta think of something else.
Yeah. Maybe we could... Oh! Call incoming. You ready?
Ready as I'll ever be. Put him through.
Alrighty. Mr. Russell, are you there?
By the skin of my teeth, I am. He came out of the kitchen almost as soon as he entered. Thank God I made it in here just a second before.
The killer already searched the kitchen. He probably didn't have to look around much.
Did he see you? Are you safe for now?
He didn't see me, no. Let me
just check the security cameras to see where he went. Looks like he's heading towards the cubicles. We have enough intern desks to keep him busy for a little while. I'm not out of the woods yet, though.
Right. Let's review where we are. So, the only way out is by the stairs, which the whistling man has blocked with furniture.
Exactly. I can move the furniture out of the way, but not quickly or quietly.
Could you lock him in a room? That'd probably buy you time enough, right?
Maybe. But the damn fire regulations say every door in the office has to unlock from the inside. He'd be able to get out just as soon as... No, I got it. The secret archive through my office, where we keep our most sensitive records.
Ooh, a secret archive? Reggie would love that. What have you got back there? Juicy secrets about outer space?
Peggy, I don't think now's the time to be playing around like that.
You're right. Sorry, Forrest.
Kids, we're in the big time now. I've got it all figured out. The secret archive. There's no lock on the inside of that room, only the outside. You can't break out. If we can get him in there, and I lock him in...
We can catch the son of a gun.
Exactly.
Oh my God, Forrest, we might be able to end the nightmare right here. So should I call the secret archive then?
You can't. The archive is a room for secrets, not gossip. So we don't have a phone in there.
Oh, we're gonna need to change it up then. Any ideas, Forrest?
Maybe we could use a radio.
There's no radio in the secret archives.
Are there no radios at your offices?
I don't have one in my office, but...
What is it?
Our sports reporter, Hopkins. He has a little portable radio he never turns off when he's here.
That might be what we need then. Is his portable radio still there?
It should be. It's what he calls his work radio. Should be here in the archives, actually. Let me just take a peek around.
Great job, Forrest. Looks like you picked the perfect place.
Yep. That was 100% just me thinking ahead. Exactly as planned.
I found the radio. It's right where I thought it would be.
It's all coming together.
I'm just gonna turn it on quickly, make sure it's still got some juice.
Maurice, turn the volume down. We don't want that thing blasting just yet.
Yeah, I knew that, Nash. I was just doing that when you yelled at me. The radio works! If I make it out alive, Hopkins might just get that day off he wanted. He's earned it.
Let's do it for Hopkins, Forrest.
Wait. Aw, goddammit. If I can't have this stupid thing turned up, how am I supposed to draw the killer? I can't be in the room when it's on, or I'm dead!
You just... Oh, that's a good point. But wait! We're the radio! We can just be quiet until you're ready!
If you can do that, then... Yeah, sure! 189.16, I know that's your station number. But a good editor always double-checks. Can you confirm that?
You got it. 189.16.
Good. I've got the radio on silent, but I'm tuned in. Now, I just need to get to my office.
Sounds like we need to make another call, Forrest. Where should we send the killer?
Call the boardroom. The extension is 04.
That might work. The boardroom is fairly close to the editor's office, but we haven't seen the killer go there yet. Are you sure?
I'm sure. Make the call.
Okay, calling the boardroom now.
He's on the move. I'll call you guys from my office in a second.
Looks like we're almost through this nightmare. Any idea what you'll say to draw the killer in?
I'm gonna do my best impersonation of Maurice. I think that'll draw the killer in.
What's your Mr. Russell impression?
I think I gave that masked freak the slip. What a great plan this is, pal!
I'll give you an A for effort. Ooh, call coming in. Here we go.
I'm here. The radio's set up in the secret archive. Just give me the signal, and I'll turn it all the way up.
Where will you hide in the meantime?
Good question. under my desk, but you can see under it. I've got a big cabinet, but that'll take me a second to get into.
Anywhere else?
Not really. There's the secret archive itself, but that's where the kill is going. I could try the cubicles, but they're pretty far away. Your judgment has kept me alive so far, Nash. What do you reckon?
Hide in your cabinet.
All right. Well, this is it. I'm going to go turn the radio up to full blast now. Don't say anything until I've had time to hide. You got it?
We know the plan. You can trust us.
Here we go.
I think it should be safe now, Forrest.
That's it! No more hiding! I'm a tough old man! I've been on the beat longer than you've been alive! Come on down, Whistling Man! Come and get a knuckle sandwich!
Listeners, this is Forrest Nash of 189.16, The Scream. And if you've just tuned in...
See you in hell, kid!
We've just locked up the Whistling Man.
Forrest, you beautiful bastard! I can't believe that actually worked!
If I'm being honest, I can't believe it either.
Thank God it's over. I'll be off now. Gotta get out of here. Write up a few notes. Call a few friends. I'd feel safer waiting for the cops to come grab this freak with some company. Hey, maybe you and me could do an interview tomorrow for the Gallows Reporter.
I'll think about it. We'll see what tomorrow brings.
I'll take that as a yes. Talk to you soon.
There we are, folks. The Whistling Man is locked up. Let's all take a deep breath.
And play some killer tunes.
Enjoy this classic by Smooth. It's their hit song, The Word. Looks like the night should be pretty easy from here on out.
Right? Thank God that's over. I guess we got some downtime now. I could ask you some questions to kill the time.
You're gonna interview me. You sure about that?
You're not so scary. Besides, we've been working together like a week now, and you're still all shrouded in mystery.
All right, shoot. What do you want to know?
Question one. Tell me about your family.
What? Come on, Peggy. That's too general.
Okay. Did anyone move with you to Gallows Creek?
Nope. Now that's too specific.
Too specific? Do you have any siblings?
I don't. I'm an only child, and my folks are dead.
Oh, I'm sorry, Forrest.
It's okay, Peggy. That's how it goes. Anyway, what about you? Any siblings? Your mom and pop still around?
I thought I was asking the questions.
You were. I'm just making conversation now.
Oh. Well, my folks went the same way as yours.
Oh. What happened there?
My dad walked out when I was about 13. He'd been a wreck for a while. Then he got himself into a wreck, and, well, that was Dad. Mom didn't take it well. She remarried pretty quick after that. She wanted to forget Dad so bad, she even made me take my stepdad's last name. So I'm Peggy Weaver now. Anyway, Mr. Weaver got sick one day, and my mom didn't last long after he went.
I'm sorry to hear that, Peg.
Don't call me Peg.
Yeah, sorry. I was just trying to be...
It's okay, I know. I'm sorry. I'm defensive about that name.
Any siblings?
Funny you mention that now. No. Not anymore. I had a sister, but I haven't seen her since before my dad. Hold on. Someone just rang the door buzzer.
What on earth could someone want at this hour?
I don't know. Do you want to go check it out?
Me? You sure you don't want to go?
I can't leave the booth while we're on air. One of Reggie's KFAM regulations. I'll pass you the key to the stairs.
Gee, thanks, Peggy.
The buzzer's on the front door. See you in a bit.
Okay, down to the first floor, then check the door. Wow, that was ominous. A tape. Play on air. Nice. New music to play.
Who was there?
I didn't see who it was.
Are they still out there?
No. They left as soon as I went down there. They pushed a cassette through the door. It says, play me on air.
All right. Put it on, I guess. Let's see what it is.
Hello, Gallows Creek. Time to
pay the
price. Time to
pay
for lies. Time to
sit there.
I will
punish
you.
I'm going to enjoy this.
I did not enjoy that.
What the hell was that? Oh, Forrest, we're still on air. Say something.
Folks, the tape you just heard was passed through our door only moments ago. I don't know how or why that came through our door with the killer locked up, but be careful, Gallows Creek. Stay home and stay safe. Give us a call if you need help. You can get us on 911.
Hey, we had a call come in. Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
Caller, you're on 189.16, The Scream, with
Ash! Shut up and listen to me!
Mr. Russell? What's wrong? Are you okay?
I said listen! He's gone! The Whistling Man is gone!
God damn it, I thought you locked him up. What's going on?
Damned if I know, Nash!
Mr. Russell, where are you now? What happened?
Well, after our call, I cleared the stairs and went home. I phoned some buddies, and we came back here to keep watch.
Then what happened?
I'm getting to that. We came back here. Door was shut, just as I left it. We had a couple of drinks, and, well, there was a bunch of us, and we were all armed. They thought we could teach the freak a lesson before the cops got him.
I don't blame you. I would have been tempted to do the same.
Have you both got a screw loose? You know what the Whistling Man's done tonight.
This was not my idea. The guys just grabbed their weapons and unlocked the door. I braced myself and...
Then?
Then nothing. The room was empty. The door was still locked. How the hell did he get out?
Are you sure it was still locked?
I'm telling you, it was locked. No way out of there. None.
Maybe. I mean, I know it's crazy, but if he's back from the dead, then...
Don't be ridiculous, Peggy.
It would explain things. I mean, how do we know he's not?
Mooney, there's no way.
Whoa, did you say something, Maurice?
Baloney. I said baloney. Look, I don't want anything more to do with this. I'm clearing out of Dodge. And I recommend you and everyone listening do the same.
He seems really spooked.
Wouldn't you be if you got attacked by a serial killer who turned out to be a demonic spirit?
He's not a demon, Peggy.
Yeah, you're probably right. But what do we do now?
Thank you again, Mrs. McKenzie, for the helpful tip. The bagger at the grocery store cannot whistle. We'll remove her from the suspect list.
Let's go to a break. I need you for a second.
All right, folks. We need to take a quick break. This one's for all those folks out there keeping the hatches battened. I know him. You love him. This is Roddy Snatcher with his new single, Final Breath. All right, Peggy, what's up?
I pushed a cassette under my door. Go play it.
You stopped the show for a tape?
Just go get it.
Or try your call again.
Straight to voicemail? My God. Are there any professionals at KFAM? This is Gina.
All right, I've got it. Did we forget an ad or something?
I don't know. It was buried in my work mail. I only just saw it. See what it says.
Play me ASAP. Off air.
That's Reggie's handwriting. And he wrote it in purple.
And?
Purple is Reggie's angry color. He only writes in purple when he's really pissed off.
He has an angry color?
Oh, Forrest. I'll give you the Reggie rundown later. Right now, you need to play that tape.
Don't worry about Gina, you know how she is. But yeah, can't wait for you to hear the new single, man. I think Final Breath is my best work yet. I really hope you and your listeners like it. And man, if you ever find your way this side of the pond, let me know. We'll have to catch up.
If Final Breath isn't played on your airwaves by the end of Mr. Nash's show tonight, the next call will be much less friendly.
That was Roddy Snatcher, Forrest! You know, Roddy Snatcher?
Yeah, Roddy and I are old friends.
I love Roddy. I Will Always Find You was my song. I wish we still had it in rotation. Oh my God, I can't believe you know Roddy Snatcher. And I can't believe you didn't tell me he sent you his new single. We have to play Final Breath. Where is it?
It's playing right now, actually.
Oh my God, I was so freaked out by the tape, I didn't even notice.
Yeah, I found it down at reception earlier. Barbara had it hidden away.
Why was she hiding it?
I mean, well, if that fiasco last Friday about the missing Knife and Easy track is any indication, folks at KFAM aren't against hoarding station music for personal use. I think we're still missing a few tracks, actually.
Barbara! Oh, never mind. Just listen to that music. God, Roddy's the best.
He is. And more importantly, we should be safe from the worst of Gina Franklin.
I think that's every time I've seen him live.
Peggy, you just talked through the whole song.
Oh, whoops. It's okay. I can just play it on loop later. Oh, shoot. I just noticed we have a caller waiting. I really hope it's nothing serious.
Evening, caller. This is Forrest Nash, host of 189.16, The Scream, and tonight's 911 stand-in.
This is Murphy!
Hello, Murphy. What have you got for us tonight?
Two things, Forrest. First, happy birthday to my son, Fernando. He's three today, and man, being his daddy has changed my life. I've learned how to live, how to laugh, most importantly, how to love.
Aw, happy birthday, Fernando.
Happy birthday, Fernando.
Thanks. And now, my other thing. I'm putting the word out to this so-called killer. You think you're tough, huh? Big man with a big knife, huh? Reuben, come face me, a true warrior at the Gallows Waste Disposal Plant. Guess what?
This is a bad idea, Murphy.
I got all the tapes in Master Robbie's Dojo series. So get ready, whistling man. You just let loose the junkyard dog.
Oh, no.
And there he goes. Ladies and gentlemen, keep your fingers crossed for Murphy as he tries to become our hometown hero. Although, having heard that Master Robbie ad earlier, don't get your hopes up too much. Anyway, we'll be right back after this commercial.
The world-famous annual Gallows Creek Harvest Festival is back! We got it all out on Giblet Field. We got the Little Miss Harvest Pageant, Princess Harvest Pageant, Harvest Queen Pageant, Cotton Candy, Corn Dogs, Cornhole, Corn on the Cob, Crokinole, Country Music, Can Jam, Jams, Jellies, Jamborees, Juggling, Roller Rickies, Roller Disco Lessons, Praying. We got baby crawling, balloon popping, balloons for sale, beard contest, horseshoes, hayride, hay toss, hey you there, safe donkeys and ponies, apple bobbing, firearm, fireworks, funnel cakes, fried dough, sheets, bitten, sand licking, cracker cramming, and cat shop. And fake tattoo, face painting, puppets, petting zoo, amazing maze maze, square dancing, story swapping, spelling bee, quilting bee, and sewing circle, pie eating, lawnmower racing, hot dog eating contest, flower contest, and of course our famous gourd measure-off. The festival is brought to you by Mayor Linda Cartwright, sponsored by Gallows & Sons Factory, and dedicated to the memory of Garrett Miley, tragically taken from us last festival.
I can see why it's world famous.
It's a highlight around here, Forrest.
Oh, I am sorry to hear that, Peggy. All right, folks, welcome back to the show. We have a note from my producer.
That's right. Come find me at the Harvest Festival tomorrow to grab your choice of a KFAM mug, sticker set, or poster.
Let's see what our next caller would choose.
We got a caller. You know what to do.
Hello, caller. You're live on the stream with me, Forrest Nash. Who's there? Who is this? Hello? Are you still with us?
Forrest? He called me? That horrible whistling down the phone. He's coming for me?
Jesus.
Okay, listen, caller. Don't panic. We've done this a few times now. We can help you.
A few times already? So, you saved them, or...?
We sure did. You're in safe hands.
Okay. Okay.
We're gonna help you. Can you tell me your name, caller?
I'm Dr. Sullivan. Virginia. Sorry.
Take some deep breaths, Virginia. You're gonna be okay.
Please don't let me die.
I won't. Just calm down. Tell me where you are right now. What's your address?
I'm... Oh, God.
Is there a neighbor you can call for help?
No.
You live by a frat house?
Yes, they're having a party. That takeout coming in all night. One covered in beer cans. They're getting wasted. And I'm about to get... Oh, God.
Virginia, what's the name of the frat?
It's... Oh, God. I can't think. I can't...
Any idea what the frat might be, Peggy?
If I knew where she was, I might know. But... Wait, the takeout. If we can get takeout to the frat... We can get a message to them to go and help. Virginia, who did they order takeout from?
I don't know.
Come on, Virginia. Try to remember.
I can't do this.
Well, folks, seems like our Virginia hung up. While we try to figure out what takeout to order, here's some music for your own midnight snacks. You're gonna love this next track. Peggy. What places do takeout in Gallows Creek?
Off the top of my head? Well... There's the barbecue place, Grilling Spree, and you can order from Chalupa Cabras. Oh, and of course we have Ponte's Pizza. That's it, I think.
All right. We'll call each place and ask who they deliver to tonight.
That's not going to work. Takeout client privilege.
What?
There was a lot of competition back in the day. Things got ugly. It's a long story, but what we can do is this. We figure out where the frat boys order from, call the takeout pretending to be from the frat, place an order, and include a note asking them to call the station.
There's no other way, is there?
Not that I can see.
Well, let's not waste any time then.
That's the spirit.
You got any suggestions on where to look?
Check the offices for anything food related, and maybe the kitchen downstairs. You'll need a key for that. I'll just slide it under my door now.
Thanks, Peggy. God, where to start? What would make me order from somewhere if I were a partying frat boy? We have a food critic, right? Chad or Brad or... I just have to look around.
Hey, find anything useful?
Yes, I have.
That's great. Are you ready to get back on the line?
Let's make the call.
When you're ready, shut the music off. Okay, Forrest, what'll it be?
Call Ponty's Pizza.
You got it. Ponty's Pizza is on the line.
Ponty's Pizza, may I take your order?
Fratman calling. We're in major need of foods for dudes.
May I take your order?
I need some garlic bread. I need the bread!
Can do! Where do you want that delivered?
Same place as before, you know. The frat house.
Got it. And we'll have that over to you right away.
Oh, and one more thing. Can you add a note to the order that says to call KFAM?
KFAM? Oh, consider it done. The folks at KFAM are huge fans of Ponty's Pizza, you know. I should really call them and let them know.
And now we wait.
We should put a song on.
Agreed. This one goes out to our delivery workers.
It's funky, it's groovy, it's Stabbin' the Twilight by Knife and Easy.
Which of the takeout places would you order from?
To save Virginia?
No, where would you actually eat?
Oh, I mean, they're all pretty equal.
You mean equally awful?
No, equally good. But if I had to order, not Ponty. He's not Ponty.
Right. So between Grilling Spree and Chalupa Cobbers?
I mean, it depends. Do I want a plate full of meat? Or do I want really, really good nachos? It can change depending on the day, you know?
Yeah, fair enough. Maybe I...
Hold that thought, Forrest. We've got a call coming in.
Hello, caller. You're live on The Scream with me, Forrest Nash.
Hey, this is Fratman Plunker! We got some garlic bread and a note to call this number.
Yes!
Plunker! This is Forrest Nash from 189.16, The Scream. And?
Is this Goose? Oh, man. It's totally you, isn't it, Goose? This is such a Goose prank.
Plunker, this is an emergency.
Nice try, Goose. I may be drunk, but I'm no fool.
Listen, I need you to...
Goose, come get beer. Your brothers are waiting for you.
I'm not Goose. How can I prove this to you?
Let me get a second opinion on this. Norman the Barbarian, what do you think? Great idea. Norman the Barbarian says only the radio man can control it. So, play us The Flow.
Wait, really? What? The Flow?
Norman the Barbarian demands it.
Okay. I'll play the damn song.
Oh, shit. Okay, radio man. Got my attention. What is it?
Thank God. Listen, you've got to get over to your neighbor's house. All of you, just...
Say no more. Plunker's moving the house.
Forrest, line two.
Hello, you're live on 189.16, The Scream.
Forrest, it's the killer. He's at the door. Race. Oh my God, it's you, isn't it? God, I didn't talk, I promise.
The party has arrived.
Oh, thank God. He's gone and... Oh!
Oh, is that you?
Don't worry, we brought the beer.
Good times are here.
I could use a drink. Thank you, Forrest.
You're welcome, Virginia.
And thank you to Plunker and his fraternity brothers.
Some heroes wear capes. Some wear sheets as togas.
Hey, Forrest, did you hear what Virginia said earlier?
What was that all about? Clive, I didn't talk. Do you know what she meant?
There's a janitor here at the station named Clive, but your guess is as good as mine.
All right, folks. Seems we may have a lead.
If any of you know a suspicious Clive, then please call in. It could save lives.
In the meantime, looks like we have another caller.
Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
Hello, caller. You're live on the stream with me, Forrest Nash.
It's great to speak with you, Forrest. As a local small business owner, I find this all horrifying. A killer roaming the streets of our fair town? Terrible.
I hear you there. It's a scary time for everyone in Gallows Creek. How are you holding up? You somewhere safe tonight?
Yes, Forrest, I am. I'm here at work in my small business. It's a safe, family-friendly place.
Oh, what small business do you own?
Oh, well, I'm not really big on promotion, but since you ask, it's Ponte's Pizza! The best and only pizza place in town! Come on down and get yourself a cracking deal on our 2-for-1...
Goddamn it, Ponte, no! No free ads!
I mean, I guess we can't be that mad at him. Calling Ponte's did save Virginia.
I can be mad, Peggy. That sort of thing just... I can be mad.
Look, he's gone now. We already have somebody else on the line. Just take a deep breath and let's keep going.
Evening, caller. This is Forrest Nash, host of 189.16 The Scream, and tonight's 911 stand-in.
Hi! Hello? Am I on air?
Sure are, caller. What's your name, and what have you got for us tonight?
Name's Eugene Stein, and I've got a heart full of love, Forrest. I'm hanging out in the middle of the maze, listening to your show, looking up at the stars and waiting for her.
You got a special lady coming out to see you.
Yeah. Molly. We planned to get lost in the maze tonight, to take our first journey together into the love labyrinth. That's why I'm calling, actually. I thought she'd be here an hour ago. And since I've listened all night to how cool you play it, I thought you were the perfect guy to ask. Should I call her up and ask if she's coming, or wait and see?
For real, kid?
If you've been listening all night, do you really need to ask me?
Yes, that's why I'm calling.
Eugene, you really need to go home to your parents.
My parents are dead, actually. But,
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, I guess it's not the night. Hang on! I hear some rustling. I guess she came after all. Molly! I'm in the middle! It'll take a little while to get here, but, thanks again, Forrest. It's been good talking. Oh, wait a second. Molly can't whistle. No, no! This is supposed to be the best night of my life! Not the worst!
Stay calm, Eugene. We'll get you out of this.
Carl! I'm about to die a virgin!
Listen, Eugene. Breathe, hide, and call back in a minute. We'll get you out.
I'll do it for Molly. But please, hurry!
Well, listeners, while Peggy and I deliberate, here's a track for all you lovers out there. Now it's time to go with The Flow, and this is their hit, Crying for Help. How the hell am I supposed to get him through the maze?
You know Barbara, our receptionist? She's a maze fanatic. Shame she isn't here. I was supposed to go with her last week, but she changed her mind.
Why'd she change her mind?
She went with that jerk Brad instead.
I'm so sorry to hear that, Peggy.
It's fine. I'm not the one who had to go out with that jerk Brad, after all.
Maybe we should call Barbara then, if she's so big on the maze.
We could, but I don't actually know her number. But she probably has maze stuff somewhere. Go and see what you can find. That'll hopefully be enough.
Which one is Barbara again?
Barbara! You know, Barbara! Forrest, I've seen you speak to her.
Help me out, Peggy.
She's the receptionist. Sits at reception, never does any work because she's talking to Brad all day. Ring any bells?
Right, yeah. Sorry, I guess it's just the stress of...
No excuses. Just go and find something to help us. Any luck?
Nope. We'll just have to wing it.
Oh, Eugene called while you were away. He's on line one. Time to turn the music off.
Welcome back to 189.16 The Scream. I hope you lovers like that track. And I hope we can help our lover in the maze. Eugene, you're back on air.
I'm lost, Forrest. I just ran and I don't know where I am. I'm at a crossroad, facing a tractor statue. There are hay bales painted gold on my right.
Go left.
Okay. I went left, then tried a right. I have a pig statue in front of me and a creepy rocking horse on my left.
Go backwards.
Oh, God! Why didn't I just invite her over? Oh. I'm at a crossroads. There's a pitchfork statue up ahead. Which way?
Go left.
Oh, this was how tonight was meant to go. I just wanted some love. There's a tiny barn in front of me and a scarecrow behind me. Nothing to my sides.
Go right.
Can't run much more. I just passed a cordon silo. Didn't see anything else. Please, where do I go?
Go right.
Held my breath the whole time.
I think it went pretty well, all told.
I think you're right.
By the way, why do you think Molly missed their date? Do you think she's okay?
Unfortunately for Eugene, I think she probably never left home.
Thank you for calling in, Mr. Walton. We'll make sure to add the town librarian to our list of suspicious Clives.
Remember, report a Clive to stay alive. Next caller is up, Forrest, so take it away.
Caller, you're through to Forrest Nash on 189.16, The Scream.
Hey, wonderful show tonight, Forrest.
Well, that's kind of you to say. Thank you. What's your name, caller?
You can call me Dawn. Could you play my tune, Forrest?
Your tune? Sure.
Long Ride Home.
That old song. Sure, we got it. I think I played it the other day.
Thanks. It'll be good to hear it again.
All right, folks. Coming up is that old classic.
Forrest, I don't think you're gonna find that song.
What do you mean? I played it a few nights ago.
I know, but we don't have it anymore.
What are you talking about?
I threw it away.
You threw it in the trash?
No, I threw it out the window earlier today.
Peggy, that's a bit extreme, isn't it?
Brad was annoying me all afternoon. He played it on repeat because he knows I don't like it. So I grabbed it and threw it right out of one of the office windows. Not my finest hour, but I can only take so much.
All right. So, what do we do instead then?
Let's just play a different song. We've got more important things to think about anyway.
Gotcha. Okay, folks. Here comes some unrequested music. Sorry about that, Dawn. Maybe try again tomorrow night.
Sorry.
Here comes one of my favorites.
Of all the songs to request, why did it have to be that one?
Gee, Peggy, what did the barn finds ever do to you?
Wrote that song, for one. It gets real old when you're forced to listen to it on repeat for years. Why couldn't they just request Brody? Oh, Forrest, scrap the song. We have another caller. Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
Sorry to cut the music short, folks. Callers take priority tonight. Welcome to 189.16 The Scream. This is Forrest Nat.
Forrest? Oh, thank God. It's me again. Murphy!
Talk to me, Murphy. What's wrong?
Oh, the killer got me, man. Why did I ever trust a guy named Master Robin?
I warned you not to.
Hindsight is 20/20, okay?
Forrest, we need to do something.
Goddamn piece of... He came to the gallows waste disposal plant. Beat on me, man. Carry me inside and lock me in a dumpster. I got a flashlight, but... Oh, goddamn. I smell smoke. I think he started a fire.
Hold on, Murphy. We'll call for help right now.
Gotta hurry, man. I need someone here now or I'm gonna die.
Peggy, get the fire department on the line.
On it. All right. Now just... Come on, pick up. Hi. Yes, I'd like to report a fire over at the Gallows Waste Disposal Plant. It's an emergency. What do you mean it's not operational? Why is there no backup vehicle? Oh, God damn it! Forrest, that evil son of a bitch slashed the tires on the town's only fire engine. They can't do anything. But I have a few friends who live nearby. Maybe one of them can save Murphy.
Where do they live?
My friend Alex lives on the corner of Haddonfield and Romero Street, and Catherine lives on the west end of Myers Lane. And there's Jericho on the east end of Myers Lane. But he's... old. Really old.
Okay, I'll check the map, see who would be best to do this.
All right, Forrest, who should I call? Who can help Murphy?
Call Catherine.
All right, give me a second. They're on the way. They'll call from the plant. You can direct them from there.
Well, let's hope they get there in time.
Call coming in. It's Catherine. She and Murphy are now both on the line.
Hello, Catherine. Are you there? What's happening at the plant?
The whole damn thing is up in smoke. God damn it. I'm going in. Oh, my reception is terrible in here. God, my eyes sting.
Murphy, can you see anything at all?
Yeah, I got a little flashlight. Looks like old cans, bottles, and newspaper.
What does it say on the newspaper?
It's the Henderson headline.
What was that? My reception is terrible in here. Please, Forrest, tell me where to go.
Go to recycling.
Recycling. Got it.
Come on, Catherine.
Shit. The plants must up again. I can go shredding or crushing. Which way?
Murphy, do you know what part of the plant you're in?
I'm in a dumpster, man. What do you want from me?
Do you hear anything, Murphy?
I hear my heart about to pound out of my chest.
Put the receiver up to the lid.
Good enough.
Catherine, go to the crusher.
Okay, it's super loud. We're almost out of time.
There are three dumpsters here. One for Gallows Creek Council, Henderson Disposal, and Wide Reach Municipal.
Open the Henderson container. You just get home to your son, okay?
Will do, Forrest.
Well, folks, Gallows Creek has two folk heroes tonight, Murphy and Catherine. I'm sure their deeds won't soon be forgotten.
Great job, Forrest. No time to celebrate, though. We got a caller. You know what to do.
All right, folks. Another of our good citizens is on the line. Let's see what they have to say. Welcome to 189.16 The Scream, with me, your host, Forrest Nash.
Forrest? Teddy Gallows Jr. here. I just want to say that my thoughts and prayers are with my Gallows Creek neighbors during this awful time.
Oh, it's mayoral candidate and scion of the town founders, Mr. Gallows. Are you in danger?
We need to be a town of law and order. We need cops who have the tools and funding they need to keep us safe.
Okay, Teddy.
I know you're an outsider to our little town here, Forrest. But you're really stepping up to bat for us all tonight. I just want to say thank you for taking a swing for Gallows Creek.
Jackass.
Right. Thanks, Teddy. Now, are you...
Teddy, you lowlife! This is not the time to promote your damn campaign!
I just want to make sure our town is safe and prosperous. That's why the Gallows Family Factory, founded by my father, Theodore C. Gallows, God rest his soul, which employs over 200...
Teddy, unless you've got an emergency, I'm cutting you off.
You know what? I do have a problem. A problem that's ruining our town. You know what it is?
Yeah, how about the goddamn serial killer?
The problem is that woman, our current mayor, Linda Cartwright.
Oh, here we go.
She just isn't one of us. Linda Cartwright is un-American, unstable, and...
You're not better than anyone, Teddy. Just because you inherited half the town.
Your producer sounds a little unstable, too.
Don't you dare speak to me that way.
Cut him off, Peggy.
I can guarantee this kind of thing will not happen when I take office. The moral decay of...
And that's enough of Teddy Gallows Jr. for one lifetime.
I always feel disgusting after hearing him talk. Just play an ad, Forrest. I need a minute.
We'll be right back after these messages.
Teddy Gallows Jr. is a family man, a devout Christian, and a proud patriot. Teddy Gallows Jr. is Gallows Creek. Like his father and all his fathers before him, Teddy Gallows Jr. has worked hard to create jobs, improve infrastructure, and make Gallows Creek a good place to raise a family. Unlike current mayor Linda Cartwright, Teddy Gallows Jr. lives in Gallows Creek. He's our neighbor, and he stands with our neighbors. Like Sheriff Matthews, who, after years of keeping the peace, Mayor Cartwright is trying to force into early retirement. Teddy Gallows Jr. doesn't believe in keeping a good man out of a job. Teddy Gallows Jr. believes in the American dream. Does Linda Cartwright? Help Teddy Gallows Jr. keep Gallows Creek a good American town. Help him become mayor. Take a swing for Gallows Creek. Vote for Teddy Gallows Jr.
My name is Teddy Gallows Jr., and I approve this message.
God, what a jackass.
100% grade A asshole.
Linda Cartwright isn't super herself, but she's not...
Yeah, we don't have any more of those ads to air tonight, do we?
No, just the one.
Good. I have to ask, though. Take a swing for Gallows Creek.
Oh, he set the home run record for Gallows Creek High.
Of course he's one of those guys.
Yep, he played lots of sports back in the day, and he never lets anyone forget it.
Right. Let's just get back to the show. Well, folks, hearing that reminds me that every vote matters.
That ad really made me want to take a swing at Teddy Gallows.
You mean take a swing for Teddy Gallows?
Yeah, sure.
Let's find out from our next caller who's got their vote.
Caller on line one.
Hello, caller. You're live on the Scream with me, Forrest Nash. Hello. Caller.
Who is this? I need the police.
I'm Forrest Nash. I'm standing in for 911 tonight. What's wrong?
There's a guy haunting me and my friends. I think he's killed some of them already. That's him. He's just outside. I can see him from up here.
God damn it. She's just a kid.
Where are you? Are you somewhere safe?
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Stay with me, kid. Focus.
I can't do this.
Yes, you can. Focus. Tell me, what's your name?
Sweetie, you can do it. What's your name?
Carrie.
Good, good. Carrie, listen to me. We're gonna get you out of there, all right? Now, where are you?
The old murder house. Upstairs. I'm at the end of a hall. There's a bathroom, a couple bedrooms, a closet. Oh, he's coming. Where should I go?
Go to the bathroom.
Okay, I'll... He's here. He's here. He's gonna kill me.
Forrest, I don't think we can...
Run! Okay, what the hell is going on here?
Oh, who's on the phone, Carrie? The cops? It's just a joke, jeez.
Wait, isn't that...
Jimmy, that wasn't funny, you sicko! Of course I called the cops, but some guy just answered instead.
What guy?
Forrest Nash. What the hell are you all doing?
It's prank night, old man. We're just having fun.
That's the kid. The kid who called in earlier pretending to be the whistling man.
That's it. I'm out of here.
Jimmy, this is a pretty sick thing to do.
What? It's whistling night.
That little idiot.
Whistling night?
It's a stupid tradition. Especially stupid since that one kid died back in... Would you take off that stupid mask if it's hard to breathe? Who's under there anyway? Is that you, Seth?
Idiot! Seth is right next to you. That's, wait.
Oh, no.
Who are you?
Oh, no, man!
Everyone, get inside!
Everyone, run!
You two, barricade the door. Scott, Heather, you barricade the back. As long as he's out there and we're in here, we're safe, right?
You bought time, but not much.
Forrest, we have to...
Heather, I already called the cops. Forrest picked up. He's the best we're gonna get.
Who is with you, Carrie?
My friend. We drove out to the old murder house and... Of course! The van! Who's got the keys? Jimmy had them.
Jimmy.
I'm sorry about Jimmy.
Thank you. This is crazy, Forrest.
We'll figure something out. Between all of you, there's gotta be a way to beat this. Just sit tight, okay?
Heather, shut up. If we do that, we're gonna get killed.
If only Jeannie were here.
Jeannie? Jeannie McPherson? Our intern Jeannie?
Yes. She's my best friend and the smartest one out of all of us. She stayed in tonight. Forrest, listen. We'll see what we can come up with, and, what? Scott, you're not any good at... And, no, Chad. Out of all of us, you're not the one to...
Everything okay?
No, we're figuring out a plan, but everyone's volunteering to do things they're just bad at. I think we can figure out what to do, but I don't think we can agree on who should do what. I think you'll have to be the tiebreaker. Or else these idiots are gonna get us killed.
But I...
Shut up, you... Ugh. Forrest, I'll call you back.
But I don't know anything about your friends.
Ugh. These damn kids never learn.
Are you okay?
Ugh. They do this kind of thing every year, Forrest. People get hurt.
All right. Folks, we're gonna work out a way to save Carrie and her friends. This next one... goes out to all the trapped kids out there. Let Storm Riders take you on a rock and roll ride with the Glam Jam. Peggy, you mentioned something about their friend working here? An intern?
Yeah, Jeannie. Seems a nice enough girl, but a bit head in the clouds, you know? Not sure why we took on an intern. We really didn't have the office space for one. Poor thing got tucked away in a dark corner somewhere downstairs, I heard.
All right, I'll go see if I can find her desk. Hopefully she has something we can use.
Hey, you find anything that'll help us out?
Let's just see what we can do. Peggy said her desk is downstairs.
If you're sure, Carrie's on line one, whenever you're ready. When you're ready, shut the music off.
This is Forrest Nash, back again with an unlucky caller on this unlucky night. Carrie, are you there?
Yes. We've got a plan, but we can't agree on who should do what.
You want me to be the tiebreaker?
Exactly.
I'm ready. What's the first step?
Okay. First things first. We'll need a spotter. Someone who can keep an eye on the killer. We'll need someone on the roof. It's gonna be a hard climb. We're deciding between Heather, Kyle, and Hot David.
Heather's got this.
Yes, Heather. He picked you. Now please, stop talking about all your cheerleading trophies. Part two. The whistling man padlocked the gate back to the road. Before we drive out of here, we need someone to pick the lock. Seth, Jennifer, and Scott all want to do it.
Jennifer.
Jesus, Jennifer, you carry a bump key? Why didn't you say so earlier? Anyway, that brings us to part three. Getting the van keys. I'll volunteer for this. I don't know Jimmy as well as you guys, so... it'll probably be easier that way. Then is part four.
This is a very detailed plan. I'm impressed.
Yeah,
It's weirdly easier to think when you're about to die.
You're doing great. What's the next part?
Part four. We need someone to lead the whistling man away. We need a fast runner. For this one, we're trying to decide between... Who was it again? Todd David, Cynthia, and Scott.
Hot David.
Yeah, you, do spend a lot of time running shirtless. You got this, Hot David. Sweet. Okay, let's recap. We get the eyes on the roof. A runner distracts the killer while we grab the van keys and pick the lock on the gate. Now the tricky part. The getaway.
Ooh, what's the plan there?
Well, we can't all outrun the whistling man. But he thinks we're just a bunch of stupid teens. So... Part five, we trick the killer into a trap. Someone can pretend to be injured. Who would make the most believable bait?
Who you got?
We got Lisa, Tammy, and Cynthia.
Lisa.
Whoa.
You're right, Lisa. Having to smile at rude customers is perfect practice. That should take care of the killer. And then it's time to get out of here. Finally, part six, we need someone who can drive us through the woods and back to Gallows Creek alive. Who's our getaway driver? Should it be... Who have we got? Chad? Scott? Cynthia? Whatever. Forrest, you know what to do.
Chad.
Oh, perfect. Your go-karting experience will be great, Chad. Thanks, Forrest. We'll just take a few seconds for ourselves, and then it's go time.
Sounds good. Talk to you in a sec.
Good luck, Carrie. That actually sounded like a pretty good plan.
Impressive as hell, right?
Damn straight. Oh, the kids are back already. Line one again.
If you're just tuning in, we're coming to you live with a bunch of teens about to flee a madman. Listener discretion is advised. Are you ready, Carrie?
We're good to go, Forrest.
Good luck, and Godspeed.
You got this.
Here we go, everyone. Spotter, to the roof. Go, Heather. She's off and away. All right, Renner. Get ready. Wait for the spotter's signal. Spotter says go.
The keys, Carrie. You need to get the van keys.
His face is lying next to him, Forrest. He got cut. Oh, God.
Focus. Breathe.
Right. Right. The van keys. Got him.
It's up.
Jennifer got the gate unlocked. And Hot David should be back any second. Perfect. It's working. I can't believe it's actually working.
You're doing great.
Focus. You got this.
We got this. Next step, trap the killer. All right. Wait. Get into position. Everybody else, hide. Okay, performer. Now, act like your life depends on it.
Damn gate swung shut.
was that?
It's a whistling man! Drive! Now!
Oh my God.
Please, no! No!
Carrie?
He just stared at me.
Carrie!
Carrie?
Just stared at me and walked into the woods. I don't understand.
God, you're okay.
Can you get somewhere safe?
Yeah. I can make it home.
Thank you both for helping. If you hadn't, I...
It was your plan, Carrie, and it was a great plan.
It was really all you, Carrie.
Still, I need to get home.
Breathe, Carrie. You're okay now.
I'll call you when I'm somewhere safe. Talk to you then.
Folks, that was a lot. Our thoughts go out to Jimmy's parents in this awful time. For any kids listening in, please stay inside and stay safe.
And parents, hug your kids extra tight tonight.
Here's a song for the girl walking home in the dark.
Hey, we had a call come in.
Forrest Nash here. Listeners, we've got another caller live on 189.16, The Scream. What's on your mind, caller?
Hey, Forrest. I just wanted to phone in and say that I think I speak for everyone when I say that you're providing a real service for Gallows Creek tonight. It's cool what you're doing, man.
I'm just doing my job, friend. Anyway, tell me about yourself. What's your name? Are you keeping safe tonight?
Yeah, man, I'm good, thanks. I'm at my roller rink, trying to get everything ready for the Harvest Festival tomorrow. I had a guy from Starling Security here earlier installing the Starling 4000 system, so I'm a little behind. As for my name, my friends call me Roller Ricky, and I now consider you a friend, my man.
We're friends now, huh? Well, that's kind of you to say. Thanks.
Yeah, man.
Sounds like roller skating is more than just a job to you. So is this vocational?
I wasn't always Roller Ricky. Once upon a time, believe it or not, I used to go by just Ricky. Yeah, back then, things were pretty rough. I used to roll with a bad crowd. Not all bad, but there was one guy. Anyway, some bad stuff went down. I harbored a lot of guilt for a long time and turned to the bottle. I didn't really talk about it or even know how to talk. It's just how it was. That bottle took the best years of my life. Or so I thought.
It's never too late, Roller Ricky.
How did you turn things around?
I joined a support group. I opened up about my problems, and sharing that burden just took so much weight off. It's a long story from there, but I found roller disco. I learned how to have fun again, cutting loose and making shapes. Now whenever I get down, I get down. I'm finally free from it all, man. It's important just to talk to somebody. That's the first step. Ain't that right, Max?
Aw, hello, Max.
Well, he certainly sounds like a good boy.
Max is my emotional support dog. He's a rescue dog, but I always say he's the one that rescued me. He's the best dog a guy could ask for. Of course, the first thing I did was teach him how to skate. He's better than me now, a real pro.
Max can skate?
Yeah, man! At first they said it couldn't be done, and then they said it shouldn't be done. But Maxie loves the rink, man! Is that another train, Maxie? Maxie loves trains, man. He's even got that special how to greet them.
Maxie sounds like a really special boy.
Maxie appreciates all the positivity you're throwing out, my man. You know, I'm actually hosting free skating lessons tomorrow at the festival. I think it's a great opportunity to give back to the community. Man, all this talk of skating has got me itching for a boogie. Before I switch my radio off for the night, could I request a song, Forrest? Something I can groove to, you know, something funky. It'll be me and Maxie's final boogie breakdown tonight. Then I think we'll take it down a level.
I can do that. Thanks again for calling. You and Max, be safe now, okay?
Bye, Maxie!
You got it, man. Peace!
Well, folks, this next one goes out to Roller Ricky and Max. Enjoy. You'll like this next song.
I really needed that call, you know, after everything.
Yeah, I get that. He talked a bit much for my taste, but it is inspiring to hear somebody come back from the brink like that.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
You were thinking about Max on skates, weren't you?
Well, would you look at that? Another caller on the line. What are the odds? Better take it.
Welcome back to 189.16, The Scream. This is Forrest Nash. How are you tonight, caller?
I'm doing okay. I made it home safe.
Carrie!
Hey, I just wanted to thank you for doing what you could earlier. You know, even though we lost Jimmy, and I don't know.
Hey, it's okay. You were so brave earlier. You're safe now.
I wanted to ask you why. Why he didn't... Why am I...
Why what, Carrie?
Why did he spare me? After what he did... Why let me go?
Maybe he didn't kill you because he saw you as a victim.
Maybe. But why would that stop him from killing me too? After everything he did to...
These stupid hazing nights have to stop. Carrie, you did so well tonight. Stay safe and rest. Help is coming to Gallows Creek. We just need to hold on.
Thanks, Peggy. Hey, Forrest... could I request a song?
Of course, Carrie. What song?
Any song by Blast Processor. And thank you.
This next one goes out to Carrie.
You know, what Carrie just said has really got me thinking.
About what?
The whistling man left her alone. Why? There must be a reason.
When it comes to masked whistling killers, I don't think a reason is a key part of their process.
Well, it's something to consider. I need to take a break. If you want to stretch your legs, now's the time. Just hit the Peggy button when you want to get back on air.
Let's get going, Peggy.
Alrighty, we could run another segment or... Scratch that, Forrest. We have a caller. Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
You're through to 189.16, The Scream. What's your emergency?
Hello again, Forrest. Oh, that call with the teens was awful, those poor kids. Still, I'm glad the girl didn't get hurt.
Thanks for your concern. Are you in trouble? What's on your mind?
I wanted to ask you again to play my song, Forrest. You said you were going to play it, but you didn't.
Your name was Dawn, right?
What, Peggy? Yes. Oh, well remembered. My name is Dawn, and I wanted to ask you again to play my tune, Forrest. Long Ride Home? You know, the one that Peggy said she threw outside the window?
I'll play a track for you, Dawn, but maybe pick another one. We don't exactly have that one in rotation right now.
No, Forrest. You do have it. It's just outside the window.
There's a serial killer on the loose. I can't just go outside hunting for a record.
I'm really sorry, Dawn, but we just can't get it right now.
But wasn't the whistling man just at the old murder house? That's miles from the station. It won't take you a second to grab it.
Dawn, I'm not sure if you've heard, but there's something unnatural about this freak. He's fast. I'm not risking it.
Oh, but I think you will. Forrest? Peggy, I'm calling with more than a request. I know something. I think I know who's gonna be next.
What?
Are you serious?
Play my song, Forrest. and you'll find out.
Well, folks, here's some music for you while I think things over. Hope you enjoy this one as much as I do. Is she serious, Peggy?
She's serious about hearing that song, that's for sure.
Peggy, I mean, is she serious about...
I don't know, Forrest, but we don't really have a choice, do we? If she's telling the truth...
All right, I'll do it.
You're a good man, Forrest. I'll slide you the key to the fire door.
Wait. Our fire door has to be unlocked?
Yeah, it... You know, I never thought about it, but yeah. We should talk to Reggie about that later. Anyway, I'll hold the fort down while you're out. Maybe I'll even get a caller. That could be exciting.
189.16. The Scream. With me, Peggy.
You know, I hope she'll be happy when I'm brutally murdered by the Whistling Man. Out here. In the open. Alone. Here it is. Long ride home. Bingo! I could probably survive that fall. Looks like the janitor's closet. What did Peggy say his name was? Clive? Huh. There's a key. I'll just take that. Might be important. What the hell? Peggy's not gonna believe this. I wonder how the show's going.
Isn't that such a good song, folks? And now for... Jesus, Forrest, you've been gone for ages. I thought something had happened.
Something did happen. Clive the janitor might be Clive the murderer.
What?
I'll start from the beginning. The fire door locked behind me.
Why did you heave that thing all the way up here?
Because the basement's creepy as hell, and I don't like standing around down there.
Fair. Alright, let's run through this again. We have a creepy board you found in a creepy basement, made by our creepy janitor, who you think is the creepy Whistling Man.
Yep.
And on the creepy board are the names Chuck Brody, Kim Walker, Rebecca Allen, and Aunt Williams.
Correct.
And you think one of these people will be the Whistling Man's Clive's next target.
That's right. And we've got to find them.
You said there are four locations listed there, too. The hospital, the power station, the gas station, and the trailer park. Clive must think the target is at one of those locations. Forrest, you're going to have to figure out if any of the potential targets are at one of these locations tonight. Hit the button if you need any help. How's it going?
I'm ready, Peggy.
Are you sure? We've only got one shot at this.
I'm sure. Let's do this.
Okay, name first. Who do you think the target is?
Chuck Brody.
And where will I find them?
The gas station.
Okay, I'm dialing. One moment.
Hello?
Chuck Brody! Listen, I know this sounds crazy, but we have reason to believe the Whistling Man is coming for you. You need to get yourself and everyone else out right now.
The Whistling Man? Who the hell are you? Who is this?
This is Forrest Nash. Listen, the Whistling Man's back. We found a list with your name on it, and...
Oh, God. It's today. The year I finally let myself forget.
It's today? What happened today?
Today.
I think he ran off.
Well, fingers crossed that Chuck...
Jeez!
It sounds like something blew up!
He's using bombs now?
Is Chuck?
I don't know.
Hang on, we're getting a call.
Hello?
Chuck?
Chuck!
Forrest, the whole goddamn gas station's gone up.
Is anyone hurt?
I don't think so. I got everyone to follow me out. The town's only ambulance was blown to hell, though. Yeah. Damn it, that fireball threw me. I've got to get to the hospital. I'm not feeling great. Forrest, man, I can't thank you enough, but... Yeah, I gotta go.
Wait, Damn it, we lost him. What was that about today?
Oh, Forrest, the call board is lighting up. Get us into some music while I deal with this.
Here's some music while we regroup here on KFAM 189.16, The Stream.
There's gotta be more in the basement to show us who Clive is targeting. And if that's the case, we can get ahead of him. Stop the killings before they can happen. Forrest, we need to go back down.
By we, you mean me, right?
Yep. Like I said, I need to handle all these calls. Maybe start with that creepy mannequin room you mentioned before. I still have a lot of questions about those, by the way.
Me too. A key? Was this always here? I must have missed it when I brought everything upstairs.
Hey, Forrest!
Peggy, give me some warning before yelling down the intercom.
Sorry. Buzz the intercom when you find something and want to discuss it.
Peggy, I've found a tape and a map down here.
A map of what?
Looks like it might be to somewhere in this storage area.
Weird. Well, maybe the tape will give us more information.
That's when this all began for me. Follow the maps. Find the tapes. I'll be waiting.
Wait. George Barrow? We all heard that he drowned after a night out drinking. Was it actually Clive? Has Clive really been the Whistling Man for that long?
He says I need to follow the maps and find the tapes. I guess that's what this map is about.
I think we need to see what else is hidden down here. Be careful, Forrest. Keep looking. Buzz the intercom when you found something.
Time of autopsy is 7:00.
Small lacerations to arms, legs, and face.
This looks useful.
Preliminary toxicology. Additionally, there appears to be...
If you're listening to this, then I'm probably dead.
What the...
I'm a man who likes to stay informed.
A new vinyl for my collection.
I've got subscriptions to newspapers all over the country.
It is the coroner's opinion that the subject this likely has to be feared important. For his life and was chased.
It's an autopsy tape. Doesn't say for who, but I think it must be for George.
Poor George. He was so young.
Something's bugging me, Peggy.
What do you mean?
I swear I recognize the voice of the woman talking on the tape. I just can't place it.
Seriously? Do you think you've met her before?
I don't know. I mean, I just got here recently. I don't know. Found another tape. It talks more about how George died.
What did it say?
It sounds like he was running for his life, sprinting through trees and bushes, getting cut up all over.
What would drive someone to do that?
I'm not sure yet. There's also a tape about a toxicology report. There were no signs of drinking or that he was on anything.
What? But everyone said he went swimming drunk and drowned. It was in the newspaper and everything.
I found a written autopsy report.
What does it say?
According to that, it's just like you said at the start. George drowned after getting drunk. Said he liked to fight, too.
But that contradicts the tape.
I know. And I think I know why. There's a note with the report that says, "I'm sorry I made you do this, Virginia."
If it was on the autopsy report, then Virginia must be our coroner. Wait, the caller from earlier. When we had to call the takeout restaurants, wasn't her name Virginia?
We need to call her back once we finish down here. It looks like she might know something about what's going on. I found a tape that introduces a new detail to the story. Post-mortem injury. Apparently, his arm got caught in a car door.
A car door?
Yeah, after he died. How do you suppose they can tell?
How can they tell? I'm a radio producer, not a coroner.
The written report I found doesn't mention it at all.
How did his arm get trapped in a car door after he died?
Unless he got it when the police collected his body? I guess someone else must have moved him after he was dead to where he was eventually found.
But the report, what is going on here?
I found a police report. Mentions a friend from earlier, Sandra Sharp.
Sandra? The jazz runner?
That's right. She found George's body washed up at the reservoir.
The reservoir?
Yeah? What's strange about that?
George got cuts from running through foliage, right? But there's no forest around there. Also, how did it wash up at the reservoir?
What do you mean?
Reservoirs don't have tides.
But that's what the police report said.
It's not possible, though. I did a school project on reservoirs and got an A. But, yeah, not important right now. The important thing is that it doesn't make sense.
What are you suggesting, then? That the body was originally found somewhere other than what the report suggests. That the sheriff tried to cover it up, but accidentally let something slip?
Something like that, I think.
Well, Sheriff Matthews wrote the report. If he hadn't been eviscerated, we could have asked him.
True. But Sandra is still alive. Once we're done down here, we should give her a call.
In another tape, the coroner comes to the same conclusion as I did. George was running from something.
Maybe an animal?
Maybe, but then there's this next bit, where the coroner thinks he was moved post-death.
So she agrees with us.
At the end of the tape, someone burst in and demanded Virginia stop recording. I I think it was Clive.
This is starting to make sense now. This is a conspiracy to cover up what happened to George.
I think I found Clive's last recording. I think Clive might be gone.
Gone?
I found a confession. Not for any killings, but for playing a part in covering up George's death. He left this behind in case he died. He hoped someone would find it.
Do you think the whistling man already got him?
Possibly. We've had a lot of callers tonight, but maybe not every victim made it to the phone, you know? We don't know how many there really are.
Christ, Forrest, that's dark.
I know, but Clive said he had read about other murders in other towns, and that the murders were all folks who knew about the incident. And the killings were getting closer to Gallows Creek. He said he wanted to do something good for once.
The board in his office. He wasn't tracking people down to kill them. He was tracking them down to save them. Ugh, why didn't he just come out with all of this?
He said his employer threatened his family if he spoke out about any of it.
His employer? The one who orchestrated the cover-up? Oh, Clive. I'm sorry for thinking you'd killed all those people. Do you think you found everything?
I think so.
Forrest, what's going on here?
Someone wanted that boy's death to seem like an accident. And they hired Clive to make it look that way.
Come back upstairs when you're ready. We need to figure out our next step.
Thank God you're back, Forrest. I've been running out of stuff to pad our airtime with.
Peggy, you work in radio.
Forrest, I'm stressed. I mean, really, how are we supposed to keep a show going with all this happening?
This is our job, Peggy. We gotta do it.
You're right. So, what's the plan now?
I think we should call Virginia back.
All right, I'll get her on the line. Time to turn the music off.
Hello again, Gallows Creek. This is Forrest Nash. We're circling closer to the truth behind tonight's events. To this end, we're calling back one of our earlier callers, Virginia Sullivan.
Fredman Plunker here? Who's this? Is it you? Goose.
Plunker, hey, it's the Radio Man, Forrest Nash.
Radio Man? What's up?
Solving mysteries, saving lives. The huge.
Right on.
Plunker, what are you doing at Virginia's house?
She asked if we could stay to keep an eye out for that whistling turd. So we're hanging out, bro.
Well, that's big of you, Plunker.
Aw, it's nothing.
Can I speak to Virginia?
Sure thing, Radio Man. I'll just go get her.
Who is this?
Hey, Virginia, it's Forrest. I'm glad you're still okay.
Oh, Forrest. Sorry, I'm still jumpy.
Don't be sorry. You've been through a lot.
I'm so sorry this happened to you, Virginia.
I thought I was. I thought...
Easy. We're not calling to talk about earlier. We're calling because we think you can help us understand why this is happening tonight.
Me? What would I know?
Does the name Clive mean anything to you?
Clive? No. I don't know that name. What are you asking about this for?
You mentioned that name earlier when you called us the first time.
I don't know what I said then. I was petrified, Forrest.
Clive's the janitor at our station, and we know you spoke to him in the past.
Forrest, please. You don't know what you're doing. He'll come for me.
Virginia, it's okay. Clive won't be coming after you.
We think Clive's dead.
Dead? But isn't he? He's the whistling man, Forrest.
Why are you so certain Clive's the whistling man?
Because he... All those years ago, he...
It's okay, Virginia. He's gone. We found evidence to suggest he... well...
And we found your autopsy reports for George Barrow.
How? I saw him destroy them.
Well, he didn't. I don't know if he kept them or made copies or what, but we found them. And we know it's related to what's happening tonight, which is why we called you. Why did you write a false report?
All right. One day, I came into work to find a boy on my slab. And as I finished the autopsy, this man, Clive, he just burst in. And he started making demands to give over the reports, to falsify what I found. Of course I said no. But, well, when someone wants to make you do something, they can use the carrot or the stick. For me, he used both. You see, my sister is sick. She has a chronic condition that's never going away. It's expensive to treat, and it was getting to where I couldn't afford it. And Clive promised me that his employer would pay for my sister's treatment if I did what he said, and that if I ever spoke about this, he'd beat me to within an inch of my life. I don't know why he had me do it, but my sister needed me. You have to understand. She needed me.
We understand.
Thank you, Virginia. That was brave.
God, I just want this nightmare to end.
This will help end it, Virginia. Thank you.
Stay safe, Virginia. So, Virginia is tied up in all of this.
Clive threatened her to keep quiet about George's death. But for who? Why cover up these details? Well, we know Sandra was involved in George's death. Do you want to call her?
I do.
All right, but before we go asking questions, I think we should know what we want to ask. Is that fair?
Yeah, we need to ask her about finding the body. She was the one who discovered it, but something just doesn't add up.
100%. She knows more than she's saying.
I wonder what she's hiding.
We'll hopefully find out soon. Anyway, just be careful when you're talking to her. Don't push too hard. We don't want her to hang up.
I'll be careful.
All right, calling her now. Hopefully she's at her jazz studio. Aha! Forrest, you're through.
Hello, this is Sandra at Jazz Pizzazz Jazz Studio. Who is this?
Hello again, Sandra! It's Forrest Nash of 189.16, The Scream. And you're live on air.
Oh, I always thought folks called into a radio show, not the other way around. How jazzy. What can I do for you?
Well, we're trying to understand what's behind the attacks tonight. We had a few questions.
Why, Forrest, of course. Heck, after the way you saved my life, I'd say yes to just about anything you asked.
Do you know why the whistling man might have targeted you?
Ha! As far as I could tell, he was just a knife-wielding psycho with superhuman cardio. He'd have chased after anybody.
Right. Well, we think he might be chasing specific people. People who know about the death of a boy named George.
I don't know anything about that. Sorry.
Sandra, we know you found George's body. We have the police report.
I don't know what you mean.
It's okay, Sandra. We know.
You do? You know about?
Yes. Of course.
This studio is my life. After I found the body in the river, I couldn't lose my studio. Do you understand?
Sure. I understand.
When the rent just kept going up, he said he'd stop if I just needed to keep quiet. And everything would be okay.
Of course. We understand.
I mean, it's not like I killed him. What was the harm in saying I found him in the reservoir instead of the river? Right? Right? I'm sorry. I can't do this.
And she's gone. I don't think that could have gone any better. You truly did great, Forrest.
Well, folks, if anyone out there has any thoughts on what's going on tonight, please call in.
That's good timing. We've got a call waiting just this second.
Welcome to 189.16 The Scream with me, your host, Forrest Nash.
Hi, Forrest. I know this is really out of the blue with everything happening tonight, but I wondered if you could send this special birthday message to my uncle.
You know what? I'd welcome a change of pace. I'd be glad to.
Thank you, Forrest. He's my Uncle Ronnie. His first name's Peter, but he never liked his name. But since he always had salt and pepper hair, even as a kid, can you believe it? Folks always called him Pepper.
Thanks for the history lesson. Is there anything besides happy birthday you'd like to say to Mr. Pepper? Oh my God, damn it!
Yes! Tell him he can get the best birthday deals and party packages here at Portney's Pizza! Starting at just...
You son of a bitch! Stop calling us!
Sorry, Forrest. Let's just move on. We've already got another caller on the line.
This is 189.16, The Scream. I'm Forrest Nash. You're on the air, caller. Caller. Ponty.
Ponty's Pizza always delivers! Come rain or sleet or whistling man, we'll be there!
Forrest? Forrest? Are you okay? Forrest?
I hope the whistling man gets him with his own pizza slicer.
Jesus, Forrest.
Sorry. That was too much.
It's okay. It's been a high-stress night. Don't worry about him anymore, okay? Not for tonight, anyway. I think he's spent for now. We've got another call, whenever you're ready.
Folks, don't spend your money at Pawnee's Pizza. That's all I'm gonna say about that. Moving along, I'd like to welcome another caller to 189.16 The Scream with me, Forrest Nash. Who may I say is calling?
Well, hello again, Forrest.
Don? We played your song, Long Ride Home. Did you hear it? Can you tell us?
Never mind that now. Forrest, I'm calling because I need your help.
Are you in danger?
Oh, I sure am.
Do you mean...
Yes, he's after me now.
You?
I think so. He must have heard me on the radio helping you.
Helping? You didn't exactly help.
Maybe I've been helping more than you know. I was out following a lead, trying to work out who would be next, after Chuck.
And what happened?
And I started to feel like I was being followed. I came back to my apartment building, but this newfangled security system has me locked out. I need you to help me get inside.
Can a neighbor let you in?
I only moved in last week. I don't know anybody yet. There's not even a buzzer here, only the keypad for the entry code. I need that code to get inside.
Which apartment block do you live in? Maybe one of our listeners lives there too.
It's the new Woodside apartment building between the town hall and the trailer park, but I doubt any of your listeners live there. I don't have many neighbors.
Sounds like a prime piece of real estate.
The sound really carries at night. Shit.
Sounds like a noisy part of town.
It is. Boy, I wish he'd muzzle that thing and... Oh. And now he's blasting David Scopo out of his window. This night can't get any... The whistling man. He's coming down the street. I don't think he's seen me yet. Forrest, please. I need your help. I need the code for that security system, or I'm gonna die.
What's the name of the security system?
There's a sticker on the box. It says... Starling Security 4000 is keypad, and it looks like it wants a six-digit number.
Starling Security 4000, huh?
That's right. Very newly installed.
Yeah, of course. Don't worry, Don.
Thank you, Forrest. I knew I could count on you. I'll sit out of sight. Call me back soon.
All right, folks. Here's a little tune for you all to enjoy while I try to break Dawn into her apartment. You were pretty quiet there, Peggy.
Forrest, was it just me, or was there something...
Yeah, it wasn't just you. Something was weird about that.
Yeah. Well, tell you what. We have a Starling 4000, or whatever, here at KFAM. Clive bought one for the station. Maybe we can find something to help. Well, I'm not sure who. But to help someone.
Okay, so she's locked out of the Woodside Apartments, and somewhere, Clive probably has the papers for the Starling 4000. Order delivery form. Starling must have left this by accident. The system's not even installed at Woodside. Starling 4000. User manual. Ah, these codes should come in handy.
Welcome back, Forrest. Find anything?
The Starling 4000 security manual. It's got a bunch of codes.
Good. And did you find anything else?
I saw a list of everyone else who bought the Starling 4000. Know who was on there?
Oh my god. Roller Ricky! Do you think we should give him a call? Is that crazy? I don't know what you'd say, but...
That might be a good idea.
Okay, one moment. I got the number here. Patching you through.
Shit.
He probably can't hear it over the music. Forrest, I don't know about this. This is super weird.
Just put me through to Don. I'll take care of this one way or another.
Okay, if you say so. Line one, whenever you're ready.
Don, are you there? This is Forrest Nash from 189.16, The Scream.
Oh, thank God you're back. I'm so afraid. What's the code to the gate?
The code is 191519.
Thank you, Forrest. Son of a bitch! Ah!
Is she?
Get back inside and turn on the radio. Whoever that was, she was trying to break into the ring.
She? Forrest, man, you got no idea. That was him! That was the whistling man! The alarm gave me just enough time to get my rifle. I don't like hurting folk, but I can't let anything happen to Maxie. He's my best friend, you know? Listen, man, I'm heading back inside. Gonna barricade that window. My man, thank you. You and Peggy can skate for free whenever you want, forever. That's a done deal.
Thanks, Ricky. Can't wait.
You got it. Talk to you soon.
Okay, Gallows Creek. Here's some music while we process what just happened.
So, the whistling man is a woman?
I know. I can't believe it.
She called up. You spoke to her multiple times.
Yeah, she seemed pretty normal.
Why do you think she requested that song?
To get me outside?
Maybe, but how? She didn't know the song was outside to start with.
That's right. She never actually attacked me out there.
So? What now?
I guess I should make an announcement. We do have new info.
Okay, kill the music and you can make the announcement. Okay, you're live in 3, 2...
Hey folks, this is Forrest Nash here. I hope you're all safely locked inside. For those of you listening to that last call, you might be wondering what to make of it all. Here's our take. We now believe the killer is actually a woman, one who might manipulate you into letting her in before she attacks you. We're neighbors. Look out for each other and stay safe. The killer was calling themselves Dawn. This could be a fake name. If anyone needs help or you have info on the killer, please call in. You folks have my new number, right? It's 911. Hopefully, our next caller can help shed some light on our killer.
Hey, we had a call come in.
Okay, folks, time to take a call. You're through to Forrest Nash on 189.16, The Scream.
Hey, man.
Murphy?
Damn straight.
What's going on, Murphy? You in danger again?
Nah, man. I've just been listening to the show here at home. And since you asked folks to call in if they could help out, well, I'm calling. I don't know if I can say as much as other folks have, but I figure I wouldn't be a good role model to Fernando if I didn't try to help, you know?
You're a good father, Murphy.
Absolutely. Fernando's a lucky kid.
Oh, thanks. So, what do you want to know?
Well, what can you tell us?
I don't know, really.
All right. Well, do you know anything about the death of George Barrow?
Absolutely nothing.
Okay. What about the killer herself?
Herself? Man, I didn't get my ass kicked by a lady. The man I went toe-to-toe with was a man, man.
You heard the last call, right, Murphy?
Yep.
So you know it's a woman, and you were trained by a VHS, Murphy.
I know, but... Man, how could it have been a woman under that mask?
Let's just move on. Do you know anything about the history of the Whistling Man?
No, sir. Tonight's the first time I ever heard of him.
What?
I moved here 3 years ago, man. What do you want from me?
Nothing. You and Fernando just stay safe.
Right. Sorry I couldn't help y'all more, man. Now, if you'd have asked me about gators...
Forrest, we have a call coming in.
Sorry, Murphy. I think that's all we've got time for right now.
All right. I'll catch y'all with the gator talk later. Night!
Well, folks, that was a bust. But perhaps our next caller has more they can tell us. Let's find out. This is Forrest Nash, and you're listening...
Please help me! My name is Casey Moore. I'm at 25 Nancy Drive. My best friend's been stabbed. He's bleeding everywhere. I don't know what to do. Please help me!
Somebody's been stabbed? Can you tell me what happened?
We've been out at the reservoir. We were heading back to his place when we heard this whistling all of a sudden. He just started freaking out. He screamed at me, told me to hide. I'd never seen him like that, and I just panicked and ran and hid in a bush.
Oh, no. Forrest.
Then what happened?
He went up the road and talked to someone. I couldn't really hear or see anything. It sounded like he might have known the person, and they just stabbed him.
Casey, was he talking to a woman?
I don't know. They had a mask and wore all black. That's all I know. Please, we need help here.
I'll get you help, but I need to know. Where did the masked person go?
They left! They left him to bleed out! I waited until they were gone, then dragged him into the garage and called 911.
Wait, why didn't she make sure he was dead?
I don't know. I think I heard them say something like, "It's not so funny now, is it?" Before they left, but... Please! He needs to get to the hospital! I can't drive, so... We need an ambulance!
Forrest, the ambulance was destroyed in the explosion at the gas station. You should get all the info you can.
What's your friend's name, Casey?
It's Jason! Jason Parker!
Can you tell us where Jason was stabbed?
They stabbed him in the stomach, and then stabbed him again in his leg when he was on the ground, and it's... Oh, the knife is still there in his leg!
We'll be right back. Peggy, patch us through to the hospital.
On it. Phoning St. Gabriel's now. Switch to line 2.
Hello, St. Gabriel's Hospital. How can I help you?
Hi, this is Forrest Nash from 189.16. We have a stab victim at 25 Nancy Drive named Jason Parker. He's been stabbed in the stomach and the leg. He's bleeding heavily.
Oh, God, I'm sorry. But the ambulance is... Well, you know.
I know, but please, we need something, or he's going to die.
Forrest, Listen, you're going to have to get him here. We need to see him, and we can't get there ourselves right now.
We don't have any way to drive him right now. And even if we did, he's bleeding out fast.
All right, listen. We need to buy him time to get here. That means stopping the blood first, and then finding someone to stabilize him. To stabilize him, you really need someone with first aid training. Do either of you have any?
No.
Me neither.
Damn it. I'm really sorry about this, but I have other patients who can't wait. All I can do is talk you through the procedure as quick as I can, and then leave the rest to you. You think you can handle that?
We don't really have much choice. Hit me.
Okay, from the top. If he's bleeding out, then you need to get him comfortable and try to stem the bleeding. Lay him down. Apply continuous pressure directly to the affected areas. When the bleeding slows, get a clean cloth of some kind and hold it over the wounds.
Get them comfortable. Apply pressure. Clean cloths when slowed. Got it, I think.
You said he was stabbed, right? If the object he was stabbed with is still in him, don't take it out. It's stopping the worst of the bleeding right now. If anything, you should secure it so it stays where it is.
I wouldn't have thought of that. It makes sense, though. God, that was a lot of info. But I think we can handle this.
Glad you got it so far, because there's more to go.
I'm still with you, Doc. What else do we need to know?
If he's lost a lot of blood, he may enter shock. If he does, act fast. If you apply a cloth and it's bleeding through, don't remove it. Just apply another on top of it. If it's safe, elevate his legs to get blood circulating to his vital organs. Try to keep him warm. Get him to rest and reassure him. We need the patient to stay calm.
All right. Don't replace bandages. Elevate his legs. Keep him warm and calm. This is a lot.
I'm really sorry. That's as much as I can give you right now. Try to stop the bleeding. Find someone to get him stabilized and get him here as quick as you can. Good luck.
All right, Forrest. Casey's still on line one.
I'm here. How is Jason doing?
Badly! He's still bleeding! I need help! I've been putting pressure on his stomach wound since you left, but he's still bleeding. I don't know what to do!
That's good, Casey. The nurse said to do that.
What about the knife in his leg? It's gotta be hell! Should I pull it out?
No! Don't touch the knife! The bleeding will get worse if you pull it out.
Are you sure? I'm sorry. I'm gonna stop making suggestions.
No, don't worry, Casey. We're a team here. We're all going to get Jason through this. Casey, is his leg wound bleeding right now?
I hate looking at that knife. Yeah, it's bleeding. His stomach is worse, though.
I think we need to secure the knife so it doesn't move around. Do you have anything you can tie around it?
Yeah. There's some laundry piled up on top of the dryer. Some cloths on the hood of the car, and what else? I guess I've got my jacket.
Take the cleaning rags and hold them over the wound.
I really hope these are clean. Here we go. I'm sorry, Jason. It's secure. I'm putting pressure on his stomach again. I'm starting to think we might make it.
Forrest, can I have a word?
Casey, I'm going to have a quick word with Peggy. Keep putting that pressure on and let us know when the bleeding is under control. You're doing great.
But what if something happens?
We'll still be here. Just shout if you need anything and we'll be there. I promise.
Okay. I'll wait. Jason, please be okay.
What's up, Peggy?
We can't stay on the line with her all night. Dawn is still out there. What if other people need us?
You're right. She's probably on her way to her next target right now.
Exactly. And you heard the nurse. We need someone there with training who can stabilize him. He's got to get to the hospital somehow.
Could somebody nearby help them? Maybe drive him to the hospital?
You know, that's exactly what I was wondering.
Do you have anybody in mind?
I might. A little before you started working here, KFAM did a mandatory first aid training course. Me and Karen missed it because we were away on a producer getaway.
You skipped it, didn't you? Never mind. So, how does KFAM's first aid course help us?
Casey said they're at 25 Nancy Drive, right?
Yeah? Why?
They put up a bunch of cheap houses around there about 10 years ago. So a bunch of people here at the station live around there.
Do you think any of them could help Casey and Jason?
Probably, but I don't know who lives there. And since I missed the training day, I don't know who knows first aid.
Could you call them and ask?
I don't know everybody's numbers. I've only ever called Karen. Everybody's personnel info is probably in Reggie's office.
Got it. I'll look through their files in Reggie's office. It's a life or death situation. I'm sure they won't mind.
Right. But there are a couple of problems with that.
Naturally.
It's sensitive information, so Reggie probably locked it in his safe.
Great. Great. Do you have any idea what the combo for the safe could be?
Not a clue. Reggie's a serial note taker, though. Maybe something in his office will give it away. Right. There is something else.
I'm not gonna like this, am I?
Have you ever heard, the future is floppy?
Peggy, what the hell are you talking about?
I'm talking about floppy disks. Floppy disks are like these futuristic things that have information on them. You put them in a computer and they do something.
Peggy, I know what a floppy disk is.
Anyway, Reggie decided that the future is floppy and started phasing out our physical records and replacing them with these floppy disks. I imagine it's the same for our personnel files.
That's good to know. Since we haven't heard anything from Casey, I'm guessing Jason's okay for now. I'll check out Reggie's office and see what I can find.
You'll need a key for that. I'll just slide it under my door now.
Thanks, Peggy. I just have to look around.
Good. I'll patch my mic down to the office so you'll hear me over the intercom.
Looks like I need a 4-digit code.
Nice!
I'm in, Peggy. I found the floppy disks. Just put it in the slot, right?
Nancy Drive. Let me know when you've got somebody. And don't waste time on anybody that can't help us.
Hey, Peggy, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Did you find what we need?
I think I know who our best bet is to help Casey and Jason.
All right, good work. Who should I...
Hello? Is anybody there? Please pick up!
Casey, I'm here. What's wrong? God, it sounds like he's going into shock. Casey, just stay calm. It's going to be okay.
But the bleeding seemed to slow down. Did I mess up? Jason, I'm sorry.
Casey, calm down. You've done everything right. I need you to listen to me, okay? For Jason.
What did the nurse say to do about shock?
Casey, I need you to elevate Jason's legs. We need to get the blood flowing to his vital organs.
Got it.
Jason, as warm and comfortable as possible. Do you have anything you could use nearby, Casey?
Yeah. I still have some laundry next to me. I'll wrap him in some blankets. Just give me a second. Sorry. Jason's bleeding through his bandages. Should I get him new ones? Or... Oh, God.
Don't remove the bandage. Apply another one on top of him. Do you still have something you can use?
Hey!
Casey, I need you to be strong for Jason. Sit with him and reassure him that everything's gonna be okay. Okay?
Okay. But please, I can't give him what he needs. Please, help. I can't lose him.
All right, Forrest, we need to hurry. Jason doesn't sound like he's doing too well. You said you knew who to call earlier? Who was it?
We need to call John Hedges. He lives on Nancy Drive. He didn't really participate in the first aid training, but he's a former war medic. He's probably the most trained person we have.
Really? I never really spoke to him before. A war medic, huh?
Yeah, and according to Reggie's notes, John keeps all of his old equipment at his house. He's something of a hoarder.
All right. What's his number?
542-0735.
Calling now. Let's hope he picks...
Who the hell is this calling me? What time is it?
John, it's Forrest Nash here at KFAM. We have an emergency and we need your help.
Forrest? If this is a work emergency, then it can wait until the goddamn morning. Just leave me a note like everybody else.
John, no, this is a medical emergency. A man has been stabbed by the whistling man, or... Never mind. He's badly hurt, and he's going to die unless we get someone to him now.
The whistling man? What kind of joke is this?
John, we're not kidding. A man is going to die if we don't help him right now.
Seriously, I haven't been called on for over 10 years. Where's the patient? What's his condition?
He's at 25 Nancy Drive. I think we got his friend to stem the bleeding, but he's gone into shock. He's passed out right now.
You say he was stabbed? Do you know the extent of his injuries?
From what we were told, he has two major stab wounds. One to the stomach and one to the leg. The knife is still in his leg, and the stomach wound is open.
Understood. Let me grab a few supplies and I'll head right over. Damned if he dies on my watch.
Thank you, John. We'll let him know you're on your way.
Good luck.
Hello, Casey. Are you there? How are we doing? What about now? Is he still thrashing?
He's passed out. Please tell me you found someone to help.
Casey, help is on the way. My colleague will be there soon.
You hear that, Jason? Someone is coming. You're gonna be just fine. Just hold on for me, okay? Just hold on.
Come on.
Hello, Casey. This is John Hedges. I'm here about Jason. Please let me in.
Guessing that's Jason there. Casey, I'm gonna need your help. Forrest, Peggy, don't you two worry. We've got this from here.
Okay. Forrest, we'll call you back later. I have to go now.
Good luck, everyone. God, I hope he's gonna be all right.
And with that, the show moves on. We're sending our best wishes to Jason. Well, after all that excitement, I think we could use some music.
Come back upstairs when you're ready.
You're gonna love this next track.
It's getting pretty late. This might be your last break for the night, so try to enjoy it. Give me a buzz when you want to go back on air.
Let's roll.
You got it. We've got another call coming through, too.
Welcome back to 189.16, The Scream. I believe we have another caller on the line. How are you tonight, caller?
Forrest, it's me, Roller Ricky. Help! Oh, and Maxie's here too.
Good to hear from you again. How are you both doing?
Oh, we're good, man, thanks to you. You're like our guardian angel.
That wouldn't be a bad look for you, Forrest. A little white wing halo number. Maybe something for the KFAM Halloween party.
All right, everyone, let's calm down. Ricky, I'm just glad we could help you and Maxie.
Is there anything else we can help you with, Ricky?
Actually, I think I have some info that might help you.
Oh? What's that?
You see, man, me and Jason know each other.
You know each other?
Yeah, we went to Gallus High and played on the football team together. He was a gnarly offensive linesman, and I was our star wide receiver. Runner Ricky, they called me.
All right, and what does that have to do with tonight?
Well, because George, the guy who drowned, he was on our team too.
Tell me about him. What was George like?
I didn't know him for long, man, sad to say. We had our first team party on the night he drowned. He seemed like such a good dude.
Ricky, were you there when George drowned?
No, man. Once the party turned, I beat feet out of there. Man, I remember George and his girl there. There was a whole lot of love, man. I could see it, you know?
Ricky, listen, this is very important. I need to know everything about her.
I didn't really know her before, or see her after that. I never even got her name, man. I just remember he called her Bean.
Then what did she look like? Please, tell us anything you remember.
I just remember a pretty girl, man. I'm sorry.
Ricky, you said the party didn't last long. What happened?
We were just having a good time, and then the next thing I knew, everyone was running for their life. I looked up and saw the goddamn whistling man in the trees. And I never ran so fast in my life. I ran straight home. Didn't know about George until next morning at school.
I'm guessing it was whistling night, wasn't it? That the whistling man was just another kid.
Yeah. I don't know how George died, but I always felt like if anyone deserved to die that night, it should have been me. And
Ricky, it wasn't your fault. You're not a bad person.
I know that now, man. It took a long time to learn, but yeah, just thought I'd tell you all what I know.
Thank you, Ricky.
This helps. Thank you.
You got it, man. Anyway, I think it's time for me and Maxie to free up your phone lines. Thanks for listening, man. I'll let you to it.
Night, Ricky. All right, folks. Looks like we got a new lead in the case. If anyone has any info about this mysterious Bean, please call in.
If she was George's girlfriend back then, she's probably in her mid to late 30s now. Huh. Oh, we have another call coming in, but hang on.
What's up, Peggy? Peggy?
You're gonna want to take this call off the air.
Who is it?
Just do it!
All right, folks, it's time for another track. Here's one to help you sit back and relax. We'll be right back after this. I hope this is good news, Peggy. Who have we got?
Find out for yourself on line one!
Hello?
Forrest! I'm glad I got back through to you. Sounds like it's been a busy night, huh?
Surprise! It's Leslie, our 911 operator, leading the charge from Henderson to come save us. It's so good to hear from you. Are you okay?
We're doing okay. Sarah and I are both happy to be headed back home.
We're happy to have you too. Wait, Sarah?
Oh, yeah, I mean Deputy Martinez. Anyway, we got back into radio range a little while ago. We've been listening in, but haven't been able to get through until now.
Ever since you found Sheriff Matthews, it's only gotten worse. It's been a long night.
Well, it shouldn't be too much longer now. I'm glad I got through to you. I wanted to let you all know what's going on. I made it to Henderson. Turns out somebody had cut the phone lines, and they had no idea what was happening. After I told them, well, their sheriff sent a goddamn squad back with me to stop this.
That's great news! That's crazy about the phone lines, though. Do you think the whistling man cut them?
I'm guessing so. I don't know how the whistling man did it. But that doesn't matter right now. Listen, we're coming in hot. but we need your help. I know Gallows Creek isn't a big town, but if we don't know where the Whistling Man is, we can't get him. Her. That's where you come in.
You can count on us. What do you need?
It might be a long shot, but here goes. The Whistling Man already called up a few times. I bet she calls again. We're still a little ways out of town, so if she calls, stall her. Buy as much time as you can for us to get in. And while you're talking to her, try to figure out where she is. We'll be listening in, so once her location is known, we'll head straight there and end this nightmare.
I'll do my best.
I know you will. Heck, I can see the headlines now. Forrest Nash's interview of a lifetime. Anyway, I'll radio the other cars and tell them the plan is a go. Hopefully the next time I see you, it'll be with our killer behind bars. Take care now.
We'll see you soon, Leslie. Oh, thank God. It sounds like this is almost over. We're nearly through this.
Best we don't waste any time then. Let's get back on air.
You got it. Okay, Forrest, shut the music off. Bringing you back live now.
Welcome back to The Scream with me, Forrest Nash. The line is lit up, but before I get to our next caller, I just want to say, things are looking up. It's almost over. But for now, let's bring in our next caller. Evening, caller. This is Forrest Nash.
Hello, Forrest. This is John Hedges. I'm here with Casey. I wanted to give you an update on Jason.
John! Is he going to be okay?
He's a fighter. He'll be fine. We've got him stabilized and resting in a bed. We're preparing to move him to the hospital.
Thank you so much! If you hadn't been there, then... God, I don't even want to think about what would have happened.
Of course, Casey. We're just happy he's okay.
John, Casey, you two did all the work. Tell Jason to get well soon from us, whenever he's up for it.
Well, why don't you tell him yourself?
Is this Forrest?
The one and only. I hope you're feeling better.
It's good to hear you, Jason. How are you?
Oh, well, you know. I've got a hole in my stomach, and there's a knife in my leg. But John gave me something to take the edge off. So, I might feel even better than either of you.
Take it easy until you get to St. Gabriel's.
I will. But, before that, I needed to call you. I'm guessing the Whistling Man is still out there?
Yep. As far as we know, anyway.
Well, I was worried you'd say that. God damn it.
Actually, I'm glad you called. I wanted to talk to you about what happened earlier.
Go for it.
We spoke to Roller Ricky not long after you were attacked.
You spoke to Ricky? Is he all right?
He is now. I mean, he was attacked earlier, but this call came after.
Hey, guys, I'm really sorry, but there's a call on the other line. I just need to make sure we don't have another situation brewing. You fill Jason in on what happened. I'll be right back.
Sure, Peggy. Sorry, Jason, where was I? Ah, yep. Ricky's fine. You don't need to worry about him.
That's a relief.
He told us about George.
Sounds like everything's finally coming out now. It's been tough to hold it all in.
Sounds like you've been holding back about something awful, Jason.
I'm part of the reason my best friend is dead, Forrest. And the few who knew about it said if I ever said anything, I'd find myself in jail. For a long time, it was hell. And then the town just moved on. Like he'd never existed.
What happened that night?
I went along with the stupid prank, that's what. Whistling night. Some of the guys on the football team had an idea for a way we could haze the newcomers. We decided to plan a party in the woods and have the Whistling Man crash it. It was stupid. We each had a role. I was the stabbed friend. At the party that night, I left the group for a second, met our Whistling Man, pretended to get stabbed in front of everyone, started an almighty panic, those screams. That was the last time I saw or heard George alive.
How did George die, Jason?
I don't know. I was playing dead. But when I heard her scream...
Ricky mentioned a girl named Bean. Is that who you mean?
Bean. Oh, yeah. I guess George did call her that. Yeah. He called her Bean. I heard her again tonight, Forrest. Her name was...
What? What happened? Are we still on air?
No. No, we're not. Seems like the power is completely gone.
How do we get it back on?
I don't, we can use the emergency generator down in the basement. Ricky picked it up a while ago in case we ever needed to do an emergency broadcast.
An emergency broadcast?
Emergency? You know, nuclear war, alien attack, broadcasting a serial killer's location to the cops so we can end this nightmare?
Fair point!
It's in the storage area, in the far back corner, up on the wall. You might have spotted it earlier when you were digging around for all those tapes. It'll have a big red button. Just press that. I'll see you when you're back.
Far back corner. Why is this station so big? That must be it. Boom! We've got power! The whistling man. I need to warn Peggy. Why is it locked? Oh no. Peggy! Where'd you go? No way. This can't be happening. A call? Where's Peggy, Don?
Have some patience, Forrest. It's almost the end of the night. Almost the end of the show. But it's not over just yet. Got a little time still. So let's make the most of it.
What do you mean? Make the most of it how?
Well...
Huh?
I thought we'd end tonight's Whistling Man special with a special guest. The one who started it all. Let me take that out of your mouth and...
You crazy bitch! Let me go!
Welcome to the air, Mr. Teddy Gallows Jr.
Wait.
It's all gonna come out tonight, Teddy. Your daddy and his money saved you 20 years ago. But even if he crawled out of his coffin with all the money in the world...
Wait, where the hell is Teddy? How are you talking to him if you're here with me?
Because I'm not there with you, Forrest. Where that is. Well, he knows he'll get it.
I can see you. You're standing right in front of me.
Oh, I get it. You're wondering who's there at the station with you. Forrest Nash, let me introduce you and all of Gallows Creek to my boy, Henry Barrow.
Your son? You mean you... Wait, that he...
Yes, Forrest.
So there were two whistling men tonight. Of course. That explains how you were always able to get around town so quickly. And that's how you escaped the secret archives in the newspaper office.
Don't think I forgot about that, Forrest. Locking my sweet boy away like an animal.
And Murphy, he was right, wasn't he? He did fight a man.
He did. I taught my boy to never run away from a fight.
Hang on. Did you say barrel? Then, are you...
Let me just get this mask off. Damn uncomfortable thing. No wonder Moody went crazy wearing this. There we go.
Marie? Marie Campbell? George's old girl. Oh. Well, it sure has been years since I last saw. Oh, God damn it.
Marie Campbell? So, not Don, huh?
No, not Don.
What are you going to...
Everyone's gonna know now what Teddy did. He killed George that night. This night, 20 years ago.
Listen to me. You...
You're gonna talk when I talk to you. And not a moment before. Meanwhile, Forrest, I'm gonna give you the chance to talk. You're gonna help me reveal what really happened to George all those years ago.
Okay, Marie. I'll do it.
Good. Then let's talk about the night George was murdered.
Murdered? Listen, I...
I said you speak when you're spoken to. Now... I know you've done some good work tonight in piecing together what happened to George 20 years ago, and that's why I want you to interview us.
Interview you? All right, I can do that.
Thank you. I want you to help me and Teddy tell the story, Forrest. Do a good job. And hell, you might be the only one to leave here alive.
I need to drag this out. If I can buy Leslie time to get back to Gallows Creek, and if I can find out where Marie is, then this can end. Teddy, we'll start with you. Just, talk me through what happened that night. How did it start?
How would I know? It was 20 years ago.
Do you want to die, Teddy? Because if you don't start talking...
What the hell? God damn it. Okay. Our first team party was coming up. And when I saw the date it was scheduled for, I had an idea for a way we could prank the new guys.
What made that night special?
That was the night Mooney went missing. We couldn't pass it up. I was just surprised. No one had ever thought to do it before.
Wait. You mean this was the first whistling night?
Keep talking, Teddy.
We went up near Whistling Point. God, who was there? Me, Jason, and George, of course. But George didn't come alone. He brought Marie.
And Roller Ricky, he was there too, wasn't he?
Yes. Ricky was there too. Runner Ricky, our wide receiver. I helped him off the bottle, you know. Because I'm a decent man.
Is that so?
Yes, it is. He came apart one day. Some people do. He had some issues. Wasn't stable. I didn't want him to hurt his chances in life, so... I helped him keep himself together.
You were afraid he would talk about that night, weren't you?
Keep talking.
About midway through the night, we put the prank into action.
We looked up at the trees and saw Jason there, bloody, like he'd just been stabbed. And the whistling man, everyone screaming. George and I and Ricky, we got left behind, but Ricky was in
in on it, too. I know he was. He and Teddy were as close as anybody. Teddy must have told him the plan.
No, Marie, you're wrong. Ricky didn't know.
What?
Did you miss that part of the broadcast? I spoke to him earlier. He had no idea what was happening. He said he was as terrified as anybody. Isn't that right, Teddy? You didn't tell him, did you?
Ricky never could keep his mouth shut. If we told him, he would have given everything away.
But he... Well... It doesn't matter. He didn't run his mouth enough to tell anybody about it afterwards. He's still guilty.
It was just a stupid prank.
How can you still say it was just a prank?
Oh, come on! I... Oh, God! Damn it!
You made George think Jason had been murdered. He thought his best friend was dead.
And so tonight you stabbed him for real?
It's the role he wanted to play.
Jason's still alive, Marie. He was with a friend. We talked her through how to stop the bleeding and got him professional help just in time.
Oh. Well, shame he didn't have the good sense to die earlier. He's gonna regret that. Enough about him. Me and George took off running, but somehow we got separated in the woods. I ended up near the bottom of Whistling Point, and when I noticed George wasn't with me, I panicked. And then, I don't know how he snuck up on me, but the whistling man grabs me, ice cream, and he starts laughing, telling me it's just a joke.
I could stall for time here. Who was it, Marie? Who was the whistling man?
I suddenly recognized it was Chuck. Chuck Brody. It was the whistling man. Laughing away. But then he stops. And he's looking up at the top of Whistling Point.
What was he looking at? Teddy. What happened next?
Nothing. It was just...
Teddy!
George fell off Whistling Point.
How do you know what happened?
I saw it.
You pushed him. You were up there. You were dressed as the Whistling Man too, and...
I didn't push him, goddammit! I just chased him up there, and he kept backing up. When I saw he was about to go over, I reached out. That's what you saw.
You liar.
It's not my fault. He didn't know it was a joke. If he'd had any brains, he would have realized. Ugh, you bitch. No one's going to believe this. After all you did.
If she's lying, why the cover-up?
My future was at stake, Nash. You know what it's like. People like us are bred for bigger things. I'm going to be the mayor of this town, Forrest. And then governor. And then, who knows? What happened that night was tragic. It should never have happened. But it was a mistake. It was just a stupid joke, gone wrong. So my father sent Clive out to clean it up. Why should a blip ruin my future?
George was a blip?
That's an evil thing to say, Teddy.
That's the way it is. My father agreed.
Sandra found him the next morning while out jazz running.
She found him in the river, but she lied about that to protect Teddy.
She said something about her rent going up, unless she... Teddy, did your father own Sandra Sharp's dance studio?
It's Gallows Creek, not Sharp Creek.
I'd answer the question if I were you, Teddy.
Yes, okay. We own most of the town.
That's it, then. Your father was going to run her out of business unless she lied and said she found him in the reservoir instead of the river.
What my father did in his business dealings is nothing to do with me.
The false reports. That's why you killed Sheriff Matthews too, isn't it, Maria? Not just to get him out of the way, but...
Everyone was in on it, Forrest. Even the coroner wrote a fake report. Said George was drinking. That he just got himself into trouble. And...
I saw. I'm sorry. For all it's worth, Virginia didn't have much of a choice. She had a sick sister whose treatments she couldn't afford. She played along with the gallows to save her sister's life. And her own.
Even still, she should have told the truth. I did my part. I tried everything I could think of. I even went to the newspaper, but no, that coward killed the story. We'll take care of Marie's Russell later.
You've been through hell, Marie. I'm sorry.
You've got no idea. They shouldn't have pushed my George on the cliff. They should have been punished. It's coming to a stop. At least for now. Here, where George and I first met, before he joined the football team. But right after, he shot the winning throw.
Wait a sec.
We're at Gallows Creek High, in the gymnasium.
That's right, Forrest. Not that it matters, but yes, we're here. Anyway, I think that about wraps up the interview with Teddy. So...
Marie? Where? Oh my God.
Peggy!
Teddy?
You've gotta help me! I...
Quiet. You'll talk more later. Now I have to talk to someone who mattered more than you ever did. Peggy, it's been so long since I've seen your face. I worried you wouldn't come.
Marie! Oh my God, I thought you...
And here I was, thinking you'd forgot me.
I'd never forget my own sister.
Sister? Peggy, what's happening? Why are you even there?
Wanna explain, Peggy?
Earlier, while you were speaking to Jason, I got a call. Do you remember? Well, it was from Dawn. She said that my sister Marie was there that night George died, and that I should come to the gym for a reunion.
And when you walked in, you found out...
That my sister is the Whistling Man.
Good to see you too, Peggy.
Why didn't you tell me any of this?
She said that it was my last chance to see my sister. I knew if I told you, you'd try to stop me or come with me when we need you on the radio. And I just...
You should have said something. You should have told me.
I know, okay? I should have. But I didn't imagine this situation then. So just... What happened to you, Marie? You just disappeared one day.
Disappeared? I was thrown out, Peggy. I begged Mom and Dad to do something about what happened that night. But did they care? No. They told me to stay quiet. They only cared when they learned I'd been with George.
Marie, I'm so sorry. I never knew.
It's not your fault. Really, it's Mom and Dad I should be seeing right now. But since they're dead and gone, well... I'll have to settle for the next best thing.
Wait. Is that why you went after that kid in the maze? Eugene Stein? Because his parents?
That's right. Eugene's parents were there that night, too. But they got themselves killed in a bus accident. And since only their child was left...
Murray, please.
Mom and Dad are gone, Peggy. Besides, you forgot me. Just like the rest. You forgot.
Is there any way I could prove Peggy didn't forget Marie? Marie, Peggy never forgot about you!
Keep your mouth shut.
She kept a card from you. She kept it here on her desk.
What card?
The card you made me for my 8th birthday.
What does it say then?
Happy birthday, Peg. Now you're great and 8. Love, M.
I...
Henderson Police! Freeze!
No! Henry! Get out of there!
Peggy!
We have 2 wounded and we're in pursuit of the suspect.
Henderson Police! Freeze!
Forrest!
Leslie! How's Peggy?
She's been cut pretty bad, but we're here now.
I'll be okay. God, Marie!
Hey, Zara! I need you to look after Peggy. She needs help. Now, we got here just in the nick of time.
Where's Marie?
She bolted right as we got here. The police are right on her heels. It won't be long now. It's over, Forrest.
Well, folks, it was a long night, but we made it through together. I'm gonna head off to go check on Peggy. This has been Forrest Nash. And it's been a scream.